That's a big shot.
Well, this is remarkable.
Hello and good evening from Edgbaston and Bears Den TV, where tonight we will bring you live the Vitality Blast game between Birmingham Bears and Glamorgan. It all is due to start at 6:30 and our coverage is with our friends from Lord's Combustion Services. So stick around and we will have all the pre-match build-up. Now, aside from the thwack of the ball and a bit of talking out there, it's very different to how it normally is here at Edgbaston, and we do miss you, but we still really want you to be part of tonight's game. All you've got to do, you know what to do if you're on social media, use the hashtag YouBears and share with us your thoughts and how you're preparing for the game. You can also download our app. It's free on iOS and Android, and through that you can share your pictures of your Bears Den as well. Just go to the photo wall and share those pictures with us. We want to see what it looks like where you are watching us tonight, so get those pictures sent our way. And if you put them on social media, make sure you use that hashtag YouBears. Lots of smiling faces, please, tonight. Now, it does look good out there. The sun is still out, so fingers crossed we are going to get some play tonight. But before we start all that pre-match build-up, let's take a little bit of a look back at the Bears' last game, where we had a 4-run victory at Taunton. Let's take a look at the highlights.
And Somerset. This is a big shot here from Ed Pollock. There's a call of catch it. I think there's no chance of that. It's gone well over the boundary. Babarazin was watching it. Ollie Sale coming back in from the river end. This one is clipped again nicely. This one into the offside now by Pollock. A dangerous player. This is a free hit. Then Lewis Gregory in. And a great big slog drive from the batsman Pollock, who will take six for that one.
Charlie Taylor, who's trying to offer you a flat screen TV, some pizza and some Thatchers. At that one, ball is hit away from Ollie Sale by Sam Hain.
Cloud, as Waller is in. That one's flighted. It was a full toss, and that is going to go the full distance.
It's the safest place to target. There's very rarely any fielders that are down behind the bowler's arm. This time, Rhodes does take advantage of that short boundary. Sweeps Max Waller away for four, and the covers are coming on. It doesn't seem too bad out there, but you know, cricket is a summer sport.
Okay, we've got cricket going on though. It's going to be Ollie Sale from the Marcus Truscothwick Pavilion. One over left of their innings here, Birmingham Bears. They're 85 for four. The floodlights on here. It is dark in Taunton, but not here at the cricket as the lights are shining down. Ollie Sale just looking around the field, as is Sam Hain. He's 40 not out for Birmingham. This could be a really interesting over. How will this go? Ollie Sale over the wicket, bowls to Hain, who flicks it onto the leg side. Two fielders coming in to it. Oh, it's a misfield.
Could have been two, and Rudolph missed it. And he's hit another boundary as well. Sale's gone for the Yorker. Squeezed it out wide, steams in from the Marcus Trescothick Pavilion end. It's coming up near us. You're going to hear this clatter as that six into the Somerset or the Marcus Trescothick Pavilion. And what a shot of Somerset as Ollie Sale is in again, and that's going to go for six over the head of Tom Lammerby at long off. Six more. What an over from the Birmingham Bears. Oh my goodness, Ollie Sale won't want to revisit that one to bring up 5,000 T20 runs as Bresnan's in again. This time Azam flails one outside. He's gone. The big celebration from the Birmingham Bears. It was a big nick for Azam. The ball goes through to the wicketkeeper, Burgess. Azam has gone for six off three balls. What a blow that is for the Birmingham Bears, and a huge disappointment for Somerset and for Azam from the Marcus Trescothick stand end. And Davis is on the back foot. It's going to be a chance to mid on. It's well caught. Oh my goodness, Davis has gone first ball. A superb catch by the captain, Will Rhodes, at wide mid on. Davis has gone for zero. It's 14-2. Somerset in a bit of trouble here.
Yeah, having played so well in the game at Edgbaston yesterday, Steve Davies goes here in just his first ball
to win £150 in any currency. So that's four. No, it's not. That's gone. That's caught. Last ball of the power play as well, this, Charlie. This 3.3, so last ball of the power play, just 3.4 overs. This time Hildreth could reverse sweep. Barham is going to come through, but chance will run out if he hits. Hildreth could be out, and he's given out by Jeremy Lloyd.
50-4. Brooks is in around the wicket. Barham getting all of this one. Is it enough for a six? And it's taken just inside the boundary. Barham goes, and it's another one gone. 50-5 now. Somerset losing wickets quickly. And Birmingham well on top in this game, you'd have to say, in the body language from Birmingham. They're all huddled together now, enjoying another wicket going. Birmingham look like the team at the moment that will come away with a win. It's a long way back for Somerset. Someone like James Hildreth in pain like that, as Lintott is in. And Hildreth, this is Gregory attempting a sweep. He's been given out. The captain, Gregory, is gone. This is, yeah, just what we love about this sport. You just can't predict it, even to the dying moments of the game. You don't know who's going to win. It's eight balls left, 23 runs needed. I mean, it's a big ask. What can Van der Merwe do here? He's bowled! It's his leg stump out of the ground. Ollie Stone gets his man. It was an attempted scoop shot, one of the roly-poly roll-off Van der Merwe shots he was trying to do, but he missed the ball, leg stump out of the ground, and it's another wicket, 102-7 now.
Yeah, kudos to Ollie Stone. He held his nerve there. It was a big ball in the game, that. And actually, it was a nice ball for Van der Merwe to try and attempt the shot he did. So actually, look at that from a smartness of tactics perspective. He probably got that right, Van der Merwe, in terms of his plan. Pace was on. Unfortunately, he missed the ball. He lost his leg stump. And that puts Warwickshire in, you know, they're in a strong position in the game already. They're even a stronger position now. Somerset need 23 off 7.
6 to tie. We're still playing cricket. It's 9 minutes past 10 here, way past the cut-off point. I don't know what happened to that.
What are you having for dinner tonight, Charlie?
Straight through it. Harry Brooks to bowl the final ball, 6 to tie, and Lammerby knows it. It's tense here. There's no crowd in, but you can feel the tension in the players. Brooks in. Lammerby can't get it away for six. It'll come back potentially for two. And that is the game. Birmingham Bears win this one.
Fantastic performance there from the Bears. Now we're at the halfway point in the central group stage. The Bears have two wins and two losses. And of course, that first home game against Somerset was abandoned. And it was a rather wet and miserable night. Now on that night, standing next to me was Tim Ambrose. It didn't put you off. You were come back, of course, club legend. Tim, I'm going to talk to you about the team in a minute, but a bit of a mixed start for the Bears. How do you think they're going to be feeling tonight?
Yeah, it was a tough start early on. I think a very difficult home game here against Gloucester, but they've put some good performances in the last few games, and I think they'll be feeling quite confident going into this one.
We were just watching the highlights there, of course, at Taunton. Sam Hain, an unbeaten half century, and then again he backed it up in the Bob Willis Trophy this week at Cardiff. He's in fine form at the moment, isn't he?
Yeah, it's great to see Sam back to a little bit of form, a little bit of himself. But he's at a little bit of a trot. But I think it's not just the runs he scored down at Taunton, it was the fashion he scored them. He's a strong lad who hits the ball a long way. And when he sort of gets that confidence and lets himself go a bit and plays like he did down there, then it's really exciting to see. So, yeah, it's great. It's great to see him back into some good form.
We all know you've been behind the stumps in T20 matches through the years. How important is momentum in this game?
I think it is very important, but I think it's about timing as well. So you don't want to sort of get off to too much of a flyer, if you like. It's strange. It's a bit like tournament football. It's tournament cricket, and you don't want to get off to too great a start. You want to time your momentum towards the back end. So, you know, it's great. It's great to have a couple of wins. It's great to be in the position we're in. But I think we quite like where we are, in that we're going to have to put in some good performances at the back end of the group stage, going into the quarterfinals and hopefully finals day. So that's probably the right way to go about the momentum, I'd say.
Now, a little earlier, we did have the toss, and the Bears won it and have elected to bat first. So going out with a bat, it's a change. What do you think of that?
Yeah, I think it's probably a conscious plan. Obviously, the last game we played here against Gloucester, I think, on a hybrid wicket, there was a lot of runs early on, and it was a lot of pressure on the team batting second. So maybe a bit of that, and also you want to make sure that you get a chance to do both. You know, to bowl first then bat first throughout the group stages. You don't want to go into the quarterfinals or the finals day having only done one thing. So that might come into it as well, making sure that we're covering our bases, and you know, if we play well enough, it shouldn't matter which we do.
Some news from out there on the squad. Dom Sibley comes in tonight. What do you make of it, and what do you think the fans will make of it?
Yeah, it's great to see Dom back. He's had a fantastic sort of last 12, 18 months with England, and it's great to have him back in the fold, back in the change room with the lads, and the Birmingham boys will be very pleased to see him. He's had about a week or so off, and he's raring to go and play again. He's already missed the game within the last week, so it's great to have him back. But yeah, obviously Belly missing out, but I think in fairness, I think he's had a huge week, a very emotional, very personal week as well. So I think he also has a niggle with his knee as well. So I think he's going to give that a little bit of a rest.
We'll definitely have a chat about that man a little later. You've mentioned Sibley, you've mentioned Haney. Who's your man to watch tonight out there?
I think Ed Pollock's due. I think I've seen the start of some good things the last few games, and you know, when he gets going, it's fantastic to watch. But I think there might be still a little bit of pace left in this wicket, this sort of hybrid wicket. So if he can get off to a good start, I think you know, we could see some fireworks from Ed.
Okay, Tim, thank you. We'll catch up with you a little bit later. Just a reminder, the Birmingham Bears have won the toss and they will bat first. Now, he knows the rules. I'm okay on the rules, but let's get a reminder on what it is actually to play T20 cricket.
Each match is played by two teams of 11 players. Some are batters, some are bowlers, and there's one wicketkeeper. Both teams have a chance to bat and bowl. Look out for the coin toss. That's how they decide which team bats or bowls first. Each team has 20 overs to score as many runs as possible. The team with the most runs wins the game. One over is made up of 6 good deliveries from the bowler. To score runs, batters hit the ball and run between the stumps. If the ball reaches the boundary, it's 4 runs, and if it gets there without bouncing, that's a 6. While the batting team are scoring runs, the bowling team are trying to stop them and get the batters out by taking wickets. A few ways batters can be out are bowled, caught, run out, stumped, and LBW. Watch out for signals from the umpires, 4s, 6s, wickets, and these when a bad delivery has been bowled. Bad deliveries add runs to the batting team's score, and the bowler must bowl an extra ball. If you see the umpire doing this, the next ball is a free hit, and the batter cannot be out bowled, caught, LBW, or stumped. And those are all the basics you need to know to get behind your team in this year's Vitality Blast competition.
Okay, the umpires are heading out, so let's take a look at your teams for tonight. We'll start with your Birmingham Bears. Ed Pollock, Dom Sibley, Sam Hain, Adam Hose, Captain Will Rhodes, Michael Burgess, Tim Bresnan, Henry Brooks, Ollie Stone, Jake Lintott and Jeetan Patel. It's not the same without you all cheering. And for Glamorgan, Nick Selman, David Lloyd, Andy Balburnie, Captain Chris Cook, Owen Morgan, Callum Taylor, Andrew Salter, Martin DeLange, Tim van der Gugten, Prem Sisodia, and Rory Smith. So those are your teams. Of course, the Bears will be going out to bat first. So we'll have Ed Pollock and Dominic Sibley opening the batting for the Bears this evening. The weather, when we were last here, Brian, it was grim. It was raining. It's set fair for tonight. Are you looking forward to tonight's match?
Yeah, set fair. And that victory last Friday has really set the group up for the Bears, hasn't it? A victory tonight, and they can really go into the rest of the group on the front foot.
OK, so these two sides don't often meet in this competition. Take me back to, apart from, you know, a couple of weeks ago, when they the last few meters that they've had.
Well, the Bears have had the better of it over the years. They've won 10 out of the 19 with six defeats and three no results. Of course, just before that, the previous one, a couple of weeks ago, their most recent meeting was in the semi-final 3 years ago when Ed Pollock's 50 set them on the way to a very memorable victory in that semi-final on finals day.
OK, so we've had the team news today. Dominic Sibley back in. What do you make of that?
Yes, just the one change. Ian Bell missing out. As Amby said, he's just tweaked a bit of a knee, I think, down in Cardiff this week. But Sibley's not a bad replacement, is he? And one of the Glamorgan press guys has just said, well, that doesn't fill me with too much fear based on Sibley's test match scoring rate. But I think Dominic might have a bit more in his locker than they think.
OK, Brian, well, I've got to let you go because you are joining the commentary team. So I'll let you head off and I will hand over to Adam Bridge and Brian for the commentary as your Bears take to the pitch.
Weeks or so. No, and he's gone first ball. Dominic Sibley's out, just pokes it back to Prem Sisodia, who takes the catch quite comfortably. The easiest, and the celebrations, of course, are quite muted. And that's not the return to Bears cricket that Dominic Sibley would have wanted. He's on his way, and Glamorgan have their first wicket, four balls in. Sibley the man out, caught. And bold.
I was about to say how truly bizarre this must be for Dominic coming in from so much time in the test match environment and all those pressures and demands. And it was a bit of a tentative old push, wasn't it? And just chipped it back up to the bowler. So not a great start for the Bears. But then maybe they're following the pattern from last Friday because they were two for two, weren't they, then? And recovered superbly. So let's see what Adam Hose can do now. I think he's due a few, isn't he? We've had some cameos from Adam Hose, but nothing major yet.
Perhaps he had a decent summer last year. 300 odd runs. Four balls gone in the first over. Dominic Sibley just looking at his bat as he wandered off as well, as though the ball may have just sat in the wicket a little. Sisodia with a really good start for Glamorgan. Hoses forward and turns it round the corner. Bit of interest there from Sisodia. Got a long way down the wicket, Adam Hose, that time round. Good stride in. And the last ball of what's been a very good over for Glamorgan. Nicely played by Hose, who does get himself off the mark. Sisodia will field from his own bowling. And the end of the first over, a successful one for the visitors. The Bears are 2-1.
Well, Sisodia's normal strategy is to bowl the first over and then come off. But having conceded just 2 runs and taken a wicket in his first one tonight, it'll be interesting to see if that remains the case. But not a great start for the Bears, as you say. Dominic Sibley, what a level of cricket is, isn't it? Playing superbly for the Test side throughout the winter and the early part of this shortened season, and a first bowler tonight. But Ed Pollock and Adam Hove, plenty of time to have a little look. There's no need to go crazy just because of one disappointing over. And it's going to be Adam Hove's now to face more spin in the shape of Andrew Salter.
And Brian, this wicket in particular is one of the hybrid ones, isn't it, that was used?
Yeah.
It looks very true. And I mean, we obviously saw plenty of runs scored here last week.
It looks true, and all the teams that batted on it during the week seem to enjoy themselves, and these hybrid wickets don't tend to wear too much, do they? So you would think it would remain good, and it could be one of those days to take the pace off the bowling, as so often is the case in T20.
That's what Andrew Salter's going to do. Oh, and he's beaten on the outside edge, Adam Hose. Again, a long stride. But already we're seeing the pace off the ball seems to be paying dividends here for Glamorgan. Turns it into the leg side. There's no run.
Dilemma here really for the Bears batsmen, isn't it? Because of course they, with an early wicket, they can't be too reckless, but must be tempted to take advantage of the power play as well.
Again, no run. 9 balls into the Bears innings. Just 2 on the board. It's better from Hose. Couldn't resist there. He swept that one away to the boundary for 4. And that's the kind of intent that you're talking about, Brian.
Yeah, that's a very confident shot. It was a very straight delivery. So had he missed it, it would have been certainly an LBW shout at the very least. But he connected beautifully, and in the power play there aren't too many boundary fielders, so you've got to be very unlucky to pick one of them out, and that was right into the mid-wicket gap. First boundary of the innings for Adam Hose, 6-1.
Yeah, first boundary for the Bears as well, 10 balls in. Good confident strike, certainly caught it in the middle of the bat, but it's well fielded. Ed Pollock not seeing too much of the ball so far, just 3 deliveries faced as we reach the last ball of the second over. Salter just tweaking his field a little. Tim van der Gooten on this mid-wicket boundary just being moved because he was expecting Hose to do that again, and it's gone through the hands of the fielder at mid-off. It was an opportunity for sure. Desperate attempt to get there from Rory Smith to take that catch, but it's another boundary for Adam Hose. He moves on to 9, and they're 10-1 at the end of the second over. Wherever you are watching tonight's game from, don't forget you can still enter for a chance to be our Scrivens Fan of the Match. We want to see your photos from the Bears Dens at home, so send us one on Twitter using the hashtag BearsDen, and the best den will win a new Bears T20 shirt and 2 tickets to a Bears game in 2021. We'll announce the winner during the second innings of this game.
Sisodia has earned himself a second over.
He has an ill bowl to Ed Pollock. Turns that round the corner. Decent contact on it though. Picked up by Marchant De Lange, the South African. Leading wicket taker last year for Glamorgan. I'm sure we'll see ball in hand with him shortly. In the air from Pollock, but safe. Only be a single.
Yes, Ed does like the ball coming onto him, hasn't he? He's just got to work it around a wee bit, and they can't bowl 20 overs of spin, can they? So hopefully when the pace comes on, Ed will free up a bit. Adam Hose on, moving briskly onto 9. You need 65 today to get to 1,000 runs in T20 cricket. So let's hope he gets them.
Certainly come a long way to helping the Bears post a decent score here. 11-1 then, midway through the third over. beaten again outside the off stump.
A bit of turn and bounce there. I think that will be of interest to Jake Lintott and Gitan.
These hybrids do tend to bounce well, don't they, for the slower bowlers. A good shot from Hose through the gap. Despairing dive that time from David Lloyd, who's back in this Glamorgan side for the first time this season. But it's another boundary for Adam Hose. 15 for one now. He moves on to 13.
That was a lovely shot, wasn't it? Real classical cover drive. Picked the gap all along the ground. And that just shows that T20 isn't all about the big hits, is it? That was a really elegant boundary from Hose. He's looking good. 13 from just 10 balls. 15 for one.
The big hits do help, though, sometimes, don't they?
You need a few of them along the way, don't you?
This time onto the back foot. Just punches it up to long on. Just a single. One ball left in the third over.
Ed Pollock pretty much a spectator so far. Just faced the five deliveries. What can he do here?
Just reaching for that a little. Very static in the crease, Ed Pollock. And he'll pick up the single. He'll keep the strike. And at the end of the third over, the Bears move on to 17 for one.
Yes, the one, for those of you that weren't with us at the very start. Dominic Sibley back in the side today. Unfortunately, chipped up his first ball straight back to Prem Sasoji, the left-arm spinner. Sibley out, first ball for naught. That was one for one. Since then, though, Adam Hose looking in good nick. Just having a chat out there with Ed Pollock in the middle. Pollock just on three, but he's only faced six deliveries so far. And it looks like we are going to get the first over of non-spin. So let's see if Ed can free those arms.
It's Rory Smith to bowl from the pavilion end. Fourth over. First time we've seen some pace on the ball. It's full and outside off stump. Missed by Ed Pollock.
Yes, good Yorker length delivery, but Pollock might think he missed out a little bit there because there's just a third man back on the offside, so anything through the ring, and I think he'll be looking maybe to hit over the inside, over the infield on the offside as well. It's going to go away for four. Quite a long boundary on this offside, on the Hollies side of the ground this evening.
He's got that one fine and over the short fine leg that was in and all the way to the boundary for four. Ed Pollock's first of the game.
Yes, beautifully flicked away by Pollock, the fine leg fielder inside the ring, so we knew if he got any sort of contact on it, he'd clear the fielder, which he did by a few feet. And Ed Pollock's boundary count is up and running.
Not the sweetest of sounds off the middle of the bat. I'll just get a single for it. It was just over the head that time of Marchant de Langer. Just a single. Pollock moves on to eight.
He was looking for the long on boundary there, but shanked it a bit. Got right up high on the bat and a little bit fortunate. Just Marchant de Langer is a very tall man. If he was another few inches taller, he'd have plucked that one out of the air, I think. But Pollock survives. Moves to eight. Hose 14, 22 for one.
Five off the over so far. Good ball from Rory Smith. Born in Scotland, you know. Irish mother, English father, and he grew up in Wales.
He's played a couple of T20 internationals, I think, for Scotland, hasn't he? So a decent cricketer as well. All those bits and pieces in him.
Well run. Another single to Adam Hose. We're only calling him Rory, obviously, because his name looks completely unpronounceable. Maybe it's a mix of all those nations.
Well, I did take the liberty of asking our friends from Glamorgan, and they assure me it's Rory. So we'll go with that. It's nice and simple, isn't it? But they also say he's very highly rated, and this is a good, fast, accurate over, isn't it? He's bowling well here. Now let's see if Ed Pollock can do something with him this time.
Straight down the ground, he's dissected both mid-off and mid-on, and it's four runs from Ed Pollock, and it's a productive over for the Birmingham Bears in the end. 10 runs from it in total. Pollock moves on to 12, Ho's on to 15, and after four, 27 for one.
Yes, that's a solid base now after that early wicket of losing Dom Sibley. Pollock and Ho's have both connected with some good clean hits, and with plenty of power still to come for the Bears, this is turning into a decent platform. They will have more spin to come, of course, probably in the middle third of the innings, and that's going to be a testing time. But so far so good for the Bears, and I'd like to put the mockers on him, but I think Adam Hose in particular is looking in a pretty good nick tonight. Very strange, isn't it, without any fans to cheer every boundary and
no
crank
music,
up the noise.
No noise.
All the Bears fans out listening to this, wherever you are, believe me, you're being missed here tonight by the players and everybody.
Tim van der Gooten, the Dutchman, into the attack from the Birmingham end. It's going to be a wide, just drifting down the leg side. You probably can't hear it, but there was almost a real groan as he delivered that ball.
Yeah. Well, Tim van der Gooten obviously elicited a few groans from the Bears camp in the week when he bowled Ian Bell 10 runs short of what would have been a wonderful century on his last appearance in first-class cricket. So Tim's a lovely fella, but we could have done without that from him.
This one's turned on the leg side. Shy at the stumps, but safely home there, Ed Pollock. Another single for Adam Hose, 29 for one. It's amazing how when you suddenly make that decision what you're going to do, it almost just frees you up and empties your mind of everything, and you play in the manner he did in that Bob Willis Trophy game.
Yeah, I did mention that to Belly on the night before he played. I said, what happens if you go out and get a ton tomorrow? And he says, well, no, the decision is he's very comfortable with his decision, Belly, and he did bat beautifully, but I think there's a few aches and pains he could do without these days.
You're wondering where he is tonight. It's a slight knock that's keeping him out of this game. And that's gone. Ed Pollock edges one behind. Van der Gooten strikes with his second legitimate ball of the over. And the Bears are two down. And Ed Pollock is the man out in the fifth over. 4-12, caught by Chris Cook off the bowling of Tim van der Gooten.
Yes, Ed, so I'm trying to make room to slash that away over cover. And I think it just got a bit big on him. And nicked behind to the wicketkeeper. Ed Pollock not really getting going this evening. Tied down by the spinners at first. And 29 for two as Sam Hain comes to the wicket. Now Haney is in good form. Match-turning innings in the T20 at Taunton last Friday. Especially that last over when they came out after the interruption. Just one over, which he really gave Somerset a really tough target instead of just a reasonably testing one. That was a match winning piece of batting from Sam Hain. Now he's got a bit more time to work with tonight, over 15 overs. So it's Hain and Hose at the crease, 29 for 2. Pollock gone for 12.
Highest run scorer, of course, in this competition last season. I suspect he'll probably end up with that accolade this time round as well.
He's already overtaken Varun Chopra, Will Porterfield and Jim Troughton in the all-time T20 run scoring list for the Bears this campaign.
That one just gone up a little on him. Deep square leg and a third man on the boundary rope. The other two fielders outside the circle. Any standard field that aside to greet Sam Hain. Turn nicely into the leg side, into space, and they'll turn that into a two. That's really good running between Adam Hose and Sam Hain. They spent a lot of time running between wickets in this competition last season. They have an understanding, and immediately turning those ones into twos can be crucial.
Yes, they made the decision very early, which is vital, of course, when you're running between the wickets. They I think there was a shout from Haney right at the start too, and his judgment was spot on. Good over, isn't it, from Van der Goedken? They are bowling well, they're bowling straight, and they're making the Bears earn these runs.
Just to remember to plug the chair at the end of the over.
Final ball of the fifth. Still a quick single there. I think it had just been home, even had he hit the stumps. But that's five overs gone. Another wicket, though, lost in that over for the Birmingham Bears. 32 for two now from five overs. Hayne on to three. Adam Hose is on 16. And a reminder, the new England T20 shirt is now in stock at Store 94, plus a wide range of England and Bears items as well. You can visit edgbaston.com to take a look and to buy online. Final over of the power play to come. And Brian Halford's departed. It's going to be Rory Smith to continue, and alongside me is Tim Ambrose.
Hi, Adam. Yeah, it looks a tough start, to be honest, from Birmingham. I think they're looking to recover at the moment. So hopefully these two can stick together for a little while.
Smith's second over, final one of the power play, final chance to make some hay. Advancing down the wicket there, Sam Hayne. Showing that intent.
Yeah, nice and positive still from Sam and Adam here, I think. This is going to be the way forward, as you say, last over the power play. So they'll be keen to get what they can out of this one. But I think full credit to Glamorgan. They've bowled very well early on here. I think they've discovered that a bit of pace off the ball is definitely the way to go. And, you know, the guys have had to play well.
Back him on the pad. It's a big appeal. Oh, and he's given. Took a while for the finger to come up, but Sam Hayne is out. Rory Smith strikes. And the Bears are three down and in a little bit of trouble here. Not even out the power play. And already Pollock, Sibley and Hayne are back in the hutch.
Yeah, I'd be disappointed with that, Sam. I think it's usually his bread and butter there, right into his pads around leg stump. He usually feasts on those. So he'll be disappointed to have missed out, especially to a ball with a bit of pace on it as well. That was probably right there for him. So yeah, he'll be a little bit disappointed. But a crucial wicket. There's it's quite a popular thing to get three wickets in the first six in the power play. Is a really big advantage. I think all teams realise that and recognise that when they bowl. So That's not a great wicket to lose at this stage of the innings, but still got a pretty steady hand in Will Rhodes coming in now, so hopefully him and Adam can spend a bit of time together.
Don't the stats tend to back up that if you lose three wickets in the first part of the, or in the power play, you invariably go on to lose the game?
Yeah, it's certainly something that teams aim for. I know it's something we've aimed for in the past. The damage of the wickets up front can be very, very difficult to recover from, and you don't really want to bat with a recovery period in your innings. So you want to be sort of pushing the button all the way. So, yeah, difficult.
Skipper faces his first ball and turns it round the corner and all the way for four. One hand off the bat as he did it, but we'll take those runs in any way, shape or form they come, and the captain gets off the mark and the Bears onto 36 for three.
Yeah, he's bowling with quite a bit of pace here, Rory Smith. That looked to hurry Will up a little bit there, I think, in towards the ribs, and I think he was quite pleased to get something on it. But he'll take four runs as opposed to a big bruise in his rib cage, I'd imagine.
Have you played on these kind of hybrid wickets before? Is there a bit more bounce and a bit more carry?
I can't say I have, to be honest. But from what the first one I've seen here was those three games in 2 days a couple of weeks ago, and it looked a belter, to be honest. A little bit of bounce and carry is usually in the batter's favour, but it doesn't mean that, you know, if you get it right with the ball, certainly with a bit of pace, that you can't cause a few problems. And I think they've, as I said, I think they've mixed their pace well, and it's meant that the faster balls have been, you know, with the seam up, as they've utilised that well as well.
Another single. to Rhodes, who's on to five. He's guiding that one down to third man. Momentum is so important in T20, isn't it? We see it every year in the Vitality Blast. It's all teams can just gather that momentum, and the hope was that win against Somerset would have just provided that lift.
Yeah, I think that's, you're dead right. I think momentum does play a key factor, and I think they'll have gained a lot of confidence from that, and they'll have wanted to back that up. But I think with the break between the two sort of five games and then a sort of week off and then another five, this almost becomes like another section of the competition. So I think they'll, that's well played. In front of square from Adam Hayes, got his hands out nicely in front of him, met the ball, was able to place it exactly where he wanted for the boundary there, off the last ball of the power play as well.
Right in his zone.
Yeah, he plays that very strongly off his, more or less off his front foot, and he's sort of very well poised. Uses his long arms, gets out in front, and he's able to put it where he wants to. So that'll be a really good boost for him there, and for the Bears. They've not ended up too badly in the power play runs-wise, I'd say.
Yep. End of the six overs, end of the power play, 41 for three then. The loss of wickets, of course, will be the concern. They look to rebuild. Adam Hose, though, ticking over nicely. 20 runs from him so far. Will Rhodes on five, and Van der Gutten will continue from the far end, the Birmingham end. A few clouds appearing, but it's still a bright, light sky. The effect of the floodlights just taking hold here at Edgbaston, and a little ray of sunshine in the distance to the right of the scoreboard. Now, of course, they can post a few more men out, and they have. It's a deep square leg. There's a long on the cover bound, on the point boundary, should I say, and then also a third man too. Actually, a change in the bowling. De Gutten has been replaced here for Marchant De Lange, who's coming in. As we mentioned, the leading wicket taker for Glamorgan in all forms of the game last season. South African, who's been at the club since 2017. He's cut away there, and it's a despairing dive. A backward point, but it makes its way to the boundary. It's another four from Will Rhodes.
Yeah, it's well played by Will. Interesting to see how De Lange goes here. He's got a bit of pace as well. He's probably the quickest in the Glamorgan side, I would say. Usually gets a bit behind it, but it might play into the Bears' hands a little bit here. A bit of width there. Will was able to throw his hands through it and sort of take that fielder on at back a point, and he got away with it. Great shot.
That sounded nice, that. Out the middle of the bat from Will Rhodes. All the way through the covers for four. It's a terrific shot from the captain.
Yeah, fantastic hands from Will there. As I say, he looks like he's sort of going to sit back on it, use that slightly shorter side to his offside, to our left as we look out. And he's really freeing his arms up, this extra pace, I think, might play into his hand. I expect De Lange to perhaps take a little bit off the next few deliveries.
Very nicely run. A big little dab, and that brings up the 50 for the Bears. Midway through this seventh over, 50 for three. Rhodes on to 14 very quickly here from seven balls. And it's interesting, that was no fans being here is awful. We would love them to be. What we do get, though, is the crispness of some of these shots and the ball that you probably don't normally hear when there's the buzz of the crowd around.
No, you're right, it is unusual. Obviously, with the stadium environment, it sort of echoes and reverberates a bit as well. But you can clearly hear when the ball's been hit well and when it hasn't.
Who's on the defensive?
Quite an extraordinary strapping on his hand there, De Lange, on his left hand. I don't think I've ever seen that much tape on a fielder's hand before. I don't know exactly what his problem or his injury is, but he looks like a boxer. He's been strapped up. He's about to put his gloves on. It's an incredible contraption he's got going there.
Oh, and it's his right hand that goes up and just about parries it, but they scamper through for a single again. That's the end of the over. And we've had 7, 51 for 3. Rhodes on to 14. Adam Hose on 21. Don't forget to get involved this evening and follow the Bears on social media. As ever, the hashtag is YouBears. And you can follow the Bears at Warwickshire County Cricket Club on Twitter and Instagram, and Warwickshire County Cricket Club on Facebook as well. over number 8. We're going to see spin again. Andrew Salter, who opened up from this pavilion end, back into the attack, chopping and changing their bowlers. Plenty of field changes as well. Adam Hose will be on strike at the moment. Run rate not so bad. Already put 19 on these two as well. The last wicket falling at 32, but that's coming fairly swift time. Goes down the ground. Just be a single. Fielded by Smith.
Yeah, very important phase of the innings this, I think, with the spinners. I wouldn't be surprised to see them both bowl together at one stage, but they bowled well up front, and I think they bowled a little quicker with the new ball, and it'd be interesting to see if they take a bit of pace off. A couple that were a little bit slower seemed to grip and bounce a bit, so that first ball suggests Salter's looking to take a little bit of pace off. See if you can get some purchase.
And at this point, when you are almost trying to rebuild, if you milk your spinners for you know, 5 or 6 singles and over and then the odd boundary, are you content with that?
I don't think so, no. I don't think the way the game's played now. It's sort of, if you agree that this wicket's probably 160 to 180 par, just making sure you get to 150 is not going to be good enough. So I think they'll be still eyeing up their boundary options, but as I say, I think they'll probably want to have a little look and see how much it is going to grip a turn before they decide where they're going to look to go. I think Will's a very big slog sweeper of the spin, spinning either way, so he'll be eyeing up that slightly shorter boundary. Would be his option, I'd imagine. Adam, if not sweeping, he'd be looking to come down the wicket and go straight, I would say, especially if he bowls this sort of pace. So it looks a little bit slower than his first spell.
4 balls on the over gone, 4 singles so far. Not this time, a full toss, and it's whacked down the ground and it's straight into the arms of Rory Smith. That's unfortunate from Adam Hose. He's gone for 23. A poor delivery that was there to be hit. He did hit it, but he's hit it straight down the throat of Rory Smith, who's fielding at long off. And Hose is on his way for 23, and the Bears are 55 for 4.
Yeah, he'll be very disappointed with that, Adam Hose. I don't think he was expecting Salter to miss his mark by so far. They bowled very well so far tonight, Glamorgan, and that was by a considerable amount the worst delivery. So that's a bonus for them, but disappointing for Hose. Eyes would have lit up, but didn't get the connection he wanted, and managed to pick out DeLonger at long off there. So. Yeah, bad time to lose a wicket as well. I think they were, as I said, they were just probably starting to look to eye up the spinner, and that's quite a serious setback now.
It brings the wicketkeeper, Michael Burgess, to the crease. The man wearing 61, 55 for 4. Run rate of 7 and over right now, which isn't too bad, but the loss of wickets will be certainly causing some concern in that Bears dugout. Last ball of Salter's over. A good over as well. Just 4 singles from it, and the wicket of Adam Hose takes the Bears onto 55 for 4 from 8 overs so far. A reminder, keep sending in your Bears Den photos from home. We want to see you. We're in our Bears Den. So what are you up to? We've had some great ones coming already. You can do this by using the hashtag Bears Den on Twitter or via the Edgbaston app, of course, which is free to download on iOS or Android. The hashtag again, Bears Den, is what we want to see you in. A return for Prem Sisodia, who's already taken 1 wicket, of course. He's had 2 of his allotted 4 overs so far, so we are going to see the spinners in tandem. And Glamorgan just trying to turn the screw a little here.
Yeah, I think that's definitely the plan from them. I think try and capitalise on these 2 relatively fresh batsmen. Rhodes played well the last over against the seamer as well. So, yeah, they're definitely trying to get a little bit of a strangle on here. But Bears batsmen are going to have to be brave at the moment. As I say, I don't think it's good enough to just kind of bat along at 5s or 6s for the next few overs. You're going to have to keep going for it. That's what the game's about, is being brave enough to back yourself and have a good plan and execute. So I wouldn't expect them to knock it around for too long. Michael Burgess, another player who strikes the ball very well, so he'll be eyeing up some seats around the stands, that's for sure.
A loud appeal. The bowling of Sisodia again. No movement though from the umpire. Michael Burgess looked up a little uneasily, I think it's fair to say. Just a push down the ground for a single from Burgess. He'll certainly be eyeing up the ropes, won't he?
Yeah, he will in no time, I'd imagine. That one may put him off a little bit of bit more spin than he was expecting. I think we've seen a little bit more spin from that end, from the left arm. And certainly the ones he's taken the pace off, he's got a little bit more grip. So it'll be interesting.
Bit flatter, bit quicker, and it's punished by Will Rhodes. Off his legs, straying onto the pads, and away for four more. 61 for four. Rhodes on to 21 now.
Yeah, slightly outthought himself a little bit there. I think he perhaps sensed something was going to happen and tried to fire in a quicker one, but Will Rhodes was well up to that task.
It's worked into the leg side again by Rhodes. Completes the over. Just the one boundary from it. 62 for four then. With nine overs having gone, and when you reach the 10 over point, is there a reassessment? Is this always going on in the dugout, in the dressing room throughout the innings? It's kind of almost a constant reassessment, or is it still, we just need to keep going?
Yeah, I would say it's always constant. I would say also that the feedback has probably come from the wicket now already, that they'll have determined what they think is a par score. And as I say, if it looks like we're just going to bat along to be under that par score, that's not really any use. So we'll see in the next couple of overs the way they attack it, if they think they're behind the rate or above. It's one of those things you have to work out quite early when you're setting, because you don't quite know exactly what the target is yet.
Turned around the corner again by Will Rhodes. Salter into his third over. Thoughts there of Tim Ambrose, who's alongside us in the Bears' Den tonight. 63 for four now. Brings Michael Burgess back on to strike. And there is that first log sweep, but he's going to be out. Oh, it's through his hands. He's dropped it. And it's gone for four. Burgess has a life. He has his first boundary as well. Looked for all the money that was going right down his throat.
Yeah, it was more or less straight to him, but a little bit of luck there for Michael Burgess. Maybe what he needs to get himself going here, but good to see he's still showing that intent at least.
More fortune for Burgess as well. An outside edge may well find its way all the way to the rope as well for back-to-back boundaries, both rather fortuitous.
Isn't that just the rule of cricket? After you drop a catch or get what you deem to be a bad decision, the next ball almost always goes to the boundary. So, a little bit lucky to get it down there, but, you'll take those at this stage, and that takes a lot of pressure off this over as well. So they can hopefully try and wait on the bad ball a bit more. They don't have to go searching for it. So in a good position in this set of six.
Oh, and this is coming Callum Taylor's way again. He's dropped one already this over, but he doesn't do it second time. And Michael Burgess's luck has run out. He's gone for nine. This time Taylor does take the catch. It was a little higher, not quite as flat, and he was under it and comfortably inside the ropes, and the Bears are five down now in the 10th over.
Yeah, I have to say, I didn't see that coming. I thought he'd just try and work it round for a couple, and if he got a bad ball, put it away. But he obviously fancied that. His eyes lit up, and I think he hit it pretty well, but having given him practice two balls earlier down here at deep mid-wicket, I'm sure he wasn't going to put that one down again, so... Yeah, not ideal situation, but very good player still coming in. Still a few guys who can get runs down there for the Bears.
Tim Bresnan, who strides to the crease. We've obviously already seen him score a century in the Bob Willis Trophy. We know he can score runs through his days and his time with England in the past and with Yorkshire, of course. Not really the scenario you want him coming and probably flailing the bat just yet. We're two balls shy of the halfway mark here in the Bears' den, with the Bears 71 for 5. Into the back foot to play that first ball back. Second wicket for Andrew Salter. 2 for 21 so far from him, with one ball remaining is his third over. Sweeps that one round the corner, Tim Bresnan, and he grabs himself a single. He'll keep the strike, and the Bears move on to 72 for 5. Tim Ambrose will depart from alongside me, but he'll be back shortly as we prepare to move into the second half of this Birmingham Bears inning. 72 for 5 then from the 10 overs. The men out so far, Dom Sibley, who was out first ball, caught and bowled by Sisodia. Since then, we've also seen the loss of Ed Pollock, who was caught behind off the bowling of Tim van der Gooten. And we'll run through the rest of the wickets in a moment, but Sisodia is back at his mark. 1 for 16, he's into his final over. Oh, and he's bowled, Tim Bresnan. The spinner's causing havoc here at Edgbaston. Bresnan's gone for 1. And the Bears are 72 for 6 now in the 11th over. Brian, don't get too comfortable.
Well, the captain out there has got a bit of work to do here, hasn't he, to rebuild this. 72 for 6. Tim Bresnan going there. Just a relatively straight delivery. It might just have nipped away a little bit, but fair play to Sisodia. Great start to his new spell. He's got 2 for 16 from 3.1 overs, but it's not a happy story, is it? Pollock 12, Sibley first ball for naught, Hose 23, Hain 3, Burgess 9, Bresnan 1. And they've just now got to be looking to get up to 130, 140, haven't they? Give themselves something to bowl at. It does seem to be a little bit of nip in the wicket, and certainly the slow bowlers are making life difficult for the batsmen. So the Bears still in this, but they do need to find 60 or 70 more runs.
First ball for Henry Brooks to face. They'll get a single. Misfield there from Sisodia off his own bowling. And Brooks is off the mark. And the Bears on to 73 for 6. I mean, the one positive here is that Linton and Patel will probably be licking their lips at the thought of bowling on this, because there's certainly a bit of turn there.
Very much so. And I also think Will Rhodes might be quite useful in this, because he could just take the pace off the ball as well.
For now, Rhodes needs to deliver with a bat, and he is at the moment. 24 he moves on to with that single.
And of course, the return of Dob Sibley means we have another spin option as well. After Sibber's returned with the first baller, he might be keen to get ball in hand and contribute with his other skill.
Nicely turned by Henry Brooks, who's been in decent nick with the bat, really, hasn't he? I mean, he's had no choice, but he's been in decent nick.
Henry Brooks is the sort of guy that could come in at this stage of an innings and really put together a little cameo which could change the complexion of the game. He's a clean hitter. The Bears need him to do some hitting now.
It's a good ball from Sisodia. Rhodes back down the wicket. One more ball left in his spell. 2 for 19 so far. Oh, there's an indication he may well have got a little edge on that, Will Rhodes. And if it did, it's been put down by the wicketkeeper captain. And that's the end of Sisodia's overs. 4 overs, no maidens, 2 for 19. Terrific bit of bowling from the left armour. Brian, did you think there was a little nick there?
Yes, it looked like it, didn't it? And let's hope that proves to be expensive for Glamorgan. But Salter at the other end, 3 overs, no maidens, 2 for 22. So there's no doubt how effective the twirlers are proving for Glamorgan. 75 for 6 from 11 overs. And the dilemma now, of course, Adam, is obviously they do need to get a crack on, but those wickets down, they also need to shore things up a little bit.
Taylor comes off the mid-wicket boundary. Brooks gathers another single. He's on to 3. Rhodes is back on strike. Pitch. Rhodes goes straight and he goes long and he goes all the way to the boundary for four. Dissecting the two fielders at long off and long on. Another boundary for Will Rhodes. He's on to 28.
That's probably the shot of the night so far, isn't it? A really clean hit, dead straight over the bowler's head. And not for the first time in his brief time as skipper. Will Rhodes leading from the front in fine style.
Won't do much more than play that back to Salter. Really nice delivery. These spinners causing all sorts of problems for the Birmingham Bears. Again, it's another good ball.
Good variation from Salter here. No doubt learned in part from the time he spent a couple of winters ago being tutored by Jeetan Patel. Jeet's obviously did too good a job on him.
That's huge from Will Rhodes. It's all the way for six, the first of the innings. It's a massive strike from the Birmingham Bears captain.
Yeah, Salter's got his hands on his head. He might think there was not quite off the middle, but there was certainly plenty of bat on that, wasn't there? And it just cleared the fielder. First six of the innings, as you say. Slightly belatedly in the 12th over.
He's into the 30s. And cleverly just takes the strike with a well-timed single. Just pushed into the leg side. We come to the end of the 12th over. 87 for 6. Rhodes is on to 35. Henry Brooks is on 3. And at this point, we'd love you to enter our player layer poll on the Edgbaston app for what you think the Bears' score will be at the end of these 20 overs. Simply scroll down from the home tab and click on the Cast Your Vote banner to enter. And a reminder, you can get the Edgbaston app for free to download on iOS or Android. 8 overs remaining then. What do we think the Bears can get to? We've said if we can put a post or a score around the 130-140 mark from this point with the wickets lost, that would be really useful. Marchant Delanger is coming back into the attack bowl with some real hostility in his first over, but still went for 10 runs. Right on the mark at the start of his second over.
It's a good start, isn't it? A good straight Yorker. And fair play to Glamorgan. They bowled well. The Bears have been made to work jolly hard this evening.
Very short run. Let's turn around the corner by Will Rhodes. Tim mentioned it earlier, that strapping that he's got on his alternative hand there. Delanger. I'm not too sure how he's going to catch a ball with that if it comes his way. Looks like it's the end two fingers that are well strapped up.
He's certainly a rapid bowler. He's also thrown the javelin for South Africa as a junior. So a dangerous and versatile cricketer. But he bowls with pace, so can Henry Brooks work with that?
That was a slash from Brooks this time. Probably beaten for pace.
Be very interesting to see what Ollie Stone makes of this, wouldn't it? Because we were saying how dangerous it is on a wicket like this when the pace comes off. Well, Ollie Stone, he can generate pace on pretty much any track, can't he? It's all from the body and through the air with Ollie, so hopefully he can be potent and knock over a couple. It's all about taking wickets now, isn't it? The Bears really need, when they bowl, they need to get into Glamorgan quickly.
A few field changes as Brooks just runs that one down to third man. It's collected by Prem Sisodia. His work is done with the ball. Another single to the total. 89 for 6. Brooks on to 4. Rhodes on to 36 now. 24 balls. Again, straying onto the pads. One of the advantages of this right-hand, left-hand combination is just unsettling Delanger's line a little. Another single, 37 for Rhodes, 90 for 6.
Every over that passes by without a boundary will delight Glamorgan. Just one more ball in this one. See what Henry Brooks can find from it.
Oh, he's got a little nick on that, and it's gone over the goal, the wicket keeper's head, and that's gone all the way for four runs. Well, it was the boundary that Glamorgan didn't want to concede, and probably not what Henry Brooks was planning.
Well, I'm going to give him the benefit of the doubt there. I think Henry saw it got big on him, and he knew there wasn't a slip there, so he just casually nicked it, either over slip or the keeper. Let's give him the benefit of the doubt there. But it's four valuable runs for the Bears, certainly, and Rhodes 37, Brooks 8. I guess that's the sort of strategy for the next couple of overs. Just work the ball around and try and maybe get one hit in one boundary and over, just to make sure, first of all, the innings last 20 overs, because that's the cardinal sin in T20, isn't it? Not to use all the overs. 94 for 6 from 13.
Fandy Gutten is turning at this pavilion end this time. Got from the Birmingham end earlier. Picked up a wicket. Just went for 5 runs in that opening over. Rhodes on 37 will be eyeing a sizeable score here. They're going to post something up around 150. It's certainly going to be required. Cut away beautifully by Will Rhodes. It's not quite going to go all the way to the boundary. They will, however, pick up 2. Good fielding that time from Callum Taylor, who certainly got over the distress of dropping that catch when Michael Burgess cracked one to this mid-wicket boundary. Immediately, of course, took the catch soon after. A really nice piece of fielding there. Saved a couple of runs.
Rhodes on to 40, closing in on his highest in T20. He hasn't played a fat lot of T20 over the years, didn't play too much for Yorkshire. This is only his 19th T20 appearance, actually. His highest score so far, 45, so he's closing in on that, on 40 out of 97 for 6.
Always strikes me as a confident lad, Henry Brooks, as he just plays that ball into the offside.
Yes, good slower ball that from Van de Goodgun. Spotted by Brooks, who abandoned any attempt to maybe have a big swing at it when he saw the slower ball and just adjusted nicely. Moves to 9. Bit of a partnership forming here, which is what the Bears badly need.
98 for 6. 3 figures in sight. Rhodes turns that square on the leg side. They're going to go for 2. In fact, they're going to get 4. It was perfectly placed, actually. Just dissecting the fielder at mid-wicket and at deep square leg. And it brings the 100 up for the Bears in the 14th over. 102 for 6. Rhodes on to 44 within sight of that highest score. Brooks on 9. And 2 balls remaining in the 14th over.
Yes, 30 runs now added for the 7th wicket. Which is just what the Bears needed, and the captain playing a true captain's innings here on 44.
Equals his highest ever score in this competition, Will Rhodes. Seems to be relishing the captaincy role, doesn't he?
Very much so. I think double 100 down at Worcester a couple of weeks ago. Leading with bat and ball.
Well, that's a terrific shot from Henry Brooks. What a drive through the covers for 4. That's wonderful from the Bears' number 8. Takes him on to 13. Takes them on to 107 for 6 after 14 overs. And dare I say that might be the shot of the night so far.
I'd say so, and unlikely to be beaten. It might be equal, but no one's going to hit a ball harder or more sweetly timed than that from Henry Brooks, who moves to 13 and takes the partnership to 35. And that was a really good over from the Bears. Just work the ball around a little bit and then the big shot as well, just to make sure that the boundary count does go up, which it really needs to do every over. They're still playing it quite nicely now. 107 for 6, still far from a healthy position from the Bears, but...
We're thinking 150 is more feasible now?
43 off 6, yep, certainly.
DeLanger from the Birmingham end. Did well to field that off his own bowling.
Yes, 150 wouldn't be what the Bears were aiming for when they set out, but it has won plenty of T20 games over the years.
Got crammed for a bit of room there, Will Rhodes. Oh, they're going to turn it into two. Henry Brooks with a call. And it's a call that was a wrong call because Will Rhodes is gone. He's run out. Henry Brooks seemed quite confident. He made his ground, but I always felt after the first one that Will Rhodes didn't look like he fancied the second and almost has settled for a single, but the captain's gone and the seventh wicket is down.
Well, I'm afraid that's just the last thing the Bears needed. The partnership was just starting to flow so nicely, but it was just a poor call, wasn't it? There was a little bit of hesitation for Will Rhodes, I think probably because he couldn't believe he was being called for a second, and the throw was decent, and Will Rhodes was a yard short, and that's such a shame because he was batting beautifully out for 45, and just as the Bears were getting a toe hold in this innings, a new batsman has to come to the crease and start scoring pretty quickly straight away. So that is really a self-inflicted wound by the Bears. 108 for 7.
Rhodes out for 46. Ollie Stone enters the fray. Are we expecting too much from Ollie with the bat in this competition, Brian?
Well, he can hit a ball, he can hit a long ball. You wouldn't put your mortgage on him doing it too often, but it can happen and the Bears need it to happen. What a shame that was, Adam, because that partnership was just ticking over nicely, weren't they? And,
I think we may have put the mockers on it, Brian, when we started talking about 150. That may have been the reason that that happened.
Well,
I think we should shut up now.
Yeah, we could accept some blame, I guess, but I think Henry might have to hold his hands up a little bit as well for that call. And straight away, two dot balls. So that's what a wicket does, doesn't it? That's got to be the Bears' strategy when they get out there now, just to keep new batsmen in all the time and keep taking wickets. But it's going to be a hard one unless they can have some explosive impetus in this last five overs or so.
DeLanger really banging them into the surface and getting up around chest height on Ollie Stone. He's dealt with them well, though. As well to turn that one round the corner. I think he had to get a bat on that or he was wearing it. He's off the mark. 109 for 7 then. Final ball to come of the 15th over.
Two runs off the over so far. And Marchant DeLang will be delighted at that. Glamorgan will be delighted at that. No. What's Henry going to do? Is he going to try and make up for it in this last ball?
He's on to 13, Henry Brooks. It looked good, but it doesn't pierce the inner ring. And it's no run. And 109 for 7 is where we're at. 15 overs gone. 5 remaining in this Birmingham Bears innings. As Brian Halford departs, Tim Ambrose will come alongside. And with 5 overs to go and 109 on the board, well, anything around the 140, 150 mark looks like it's, from this position, will be a good effort.
Yeah, I think, as you say, if they get to 140, 150, it certainly gives them something to try and defend. But I think, I'll be honest, at this stage, it's just imperative these two bat together for a couple of overs and make sure that they bat the remaining 30 balls they've got here. I mean, you know, if you can see yourself getting at least a run a ball, get up to about 140, you can potentially nick a few off the last few overs and get towards 150 and then, you know, ask a lot of your bowlers. But, yeah, they've got to get there first. But as I say, I think these two going to have to bat together for a couple of overs here just to make sure we get to the end of the innings.
Van der Gutten, third over. Your view on the run out? Did Will look like he wasn't expecting a second?
Yeah, perhaps not. He was also sort of played the shot slightly off the back foot, so he had to sort of regather momentum just to get down for the first. So he's actually ended up running a considerably further distance than Henry. But I mean, it was Henry's call. I can see why he fancied coming back. But yeah, I mean, good piece of fielding as well. But yeah, bad time for Will Wright. He was playing very well at that time too.
Well played by Henry Brooks, not quite finding the gap between the two fielders. It's picked up by Andrew Salter at the square leg boundary. Just another single. Takes Henry on to 14. Brings Ollie Stone on to strike. 1-1-1 for 7. Nicely played by Ollie Stone. He's gone into a gap there, but may well allow a second. And again, Henry Brooks is cool, and they get the second comfortably this time. Well run by Ollie Stone and Henry Brooks. The placement there perfect from Ollie Stone, and the tempo of it as well.
Yeah, Henry will be pleased he got back for that one. He wouldn't want to be involved in two in one innings. But yeah, I mean, you're seeing here, especially on the leg side, there's a lot of gaps. So as long as they're getting something on it, they're at least scoring off every ball, and that's going to be the target for the next few overs for sure.
Not quite off the middle of the bat. A big hoik into the leg side from Ollie Stone. Gets another single. 114 for 7 now. 26 balls remaining in this innings. So a runner ball would get them up to 140. And they have won games here with a score like that before. Little swish from Henry Brooks, but makes no contact. Fumbled by Chris Cook as well. He's fumbled a few, actually. I mean, he's taken the important catches, but he did drop one off the bowling of Prem Sisodia. He's given that the long handle, Henry Brooks. And the catch is taken quite comfortably, running in from the long on boundary. Owen Morgan takes it. And Brooks is on his way for 14. And the Bears lose an eighth wicket with the score on 114. Henry Brooks is out. And we've got four overs remaining here. And the Bears really need to try and see out these 20 overs.
Yeah, good change of pace there from Van der Hooten as well, bowling into the wicket there, allowing it to stick a little bit. And you know, Henry was striking the ball well actually there with the pace on it in particular. I think that change of pace there was very important to get him out of his rhythm. But a well held catch as well, running in there, to be fair, to the fielder at long on. But yeah, I mean, that's the difficulty. They do have to get to the end of the innings, but you've also got to score enough. As I said before, there's no point limping to 130, 135, and that's not going to be anywhere near enough. So they have to keep being positive, trying to put away what they see to be there to hit. So but yeah, Jake Lintock can hit the ball well too. So you know, these two have got to try and set up a situation where they can have one big over out of these last three, four overs, and that might just get them to the 150, which I believe they need at least, to be honest.
Lintock is the new batsman. Made a real impact for the ball since arriving in this Bears T20 side.
Yeah, he's bowled very well, and you know, it's a bit difficult at this stage in these games when the guys who still have a very large role to play in the game with the ball are being asked to get a large portion of the runs at the back end. It's really not how you draw it up, but you know, these guys work really hard on their batting, as we saw from Henry earlier. He's hitting the ball very well. Ollie Stone certainly can bat, so. And so can Lintott. So, you know, they're not just there holding the bat.
It's a well-run single. Bad bit of fielding as well, actually, from David Lloyd. It's at the edge of the circle. 115 for 8. Lintott's off the mark. At this point of the innings, you want those players that can clear the ropes, really. Well, we talked about the idea of maybe getting to 140 with a runner ball. That's looking tricky. Plenty of pressure on Ollie Stone now to deliver. Really good ball from Rory Smith right up in the block hole. It's another single for Stone, who moves on to 6, 116. Run rate still just over 7 and over.
Yeah, it seems to be all Ollie's really had to feed on is very good deliveries here from Glamorgan. He's managing to get them away for singles and get down the other end, and that's at the very least he can do. So
that's going to beat the infield. Get all the way to the boundary. First boundary from Jake Lintott. Moves on to 5. Just straight onto the leg side a little. And he's turned that one round the corner and beaten the infield.
Yes, yeah, well played. Good balance from Jake there. Made sure he didn't miss out. That was a bad delivery with this field. With your fine leg up, you really can't be straying onto the pads like that. But you've still got to put it away, and he's done that very well.
You mentioned it earlier. He's bowling at some fair old pace, Smith, isn't he?
He is getting it down. He seems to be reluctant to take the pace off, unlike most of the others. So he's really relying on getting his length right if he's going to keep the pace on. And he's doing it pretty well, to be fair.
Another single for Lintott. Moves on to 6. One ball remaining in the 17th over. 121 for 8. 19 balls of the innings remaining. Still, if they get a runner ball from here, they'll get to 140. That must be the minimum target right now. Nice looking shot from Ollie Stone. Straight to Andy Balburnie. And that's the end of the over. 3 to go then. 121 for 8 right now. And again, 1 for 26 from Rory Smith in his 3 overs today. And in terms of the bowlers that remain, it's the quickies. They've all got 1 over left each. And I think Brian made the point earlier. We talked about the spinners looking forward to this wicket, but I think Ollie Stone might quite like it too.
Yeah, I think they will. I think they're going to fire themselves up to run in and try and bowl fast. There's only a bit of pace and bounce, and you know that if the total is roughly around about what it looks like, then they're going to have to produce something special. So they might as well take the handbrakes off and try and fly in and see if they can do some damage. But Henry Brooks and Oliver Stone will be looking forward to letting go on this wicket. So hopefully some fireworks early on from them.
Van der Gutten to finish his spell. 7 off the last over, and they've started this one with a single as well as they push on towards this slightly revised target of something around 140. 122 for 8 now. Lintott onto 7. As we mentioned earlier, the record has been pretty good against Glamorgan over the years, winning 10 of the 19 encounters in this competition. Short ball that time from Van der Gutten.
Quite a cultured shot there from Ollie Stone. I think like a kind of sweep hook of some sort. Slightly slower ball, perhaps stuck in the wicket, perhaps deceived him a little bit. I think it looked like he was going to duck initially and then maybe try and swing something at it, but hoping to beat fine leg, who's up on the circle.
The Dutchman is back at his mark. Short of a length. Well played, though, by Ollie Stone. And into a good spot again between two fielders where they can get back for 2. Well run and well called early there by Jake Lintott. There are, as Tim was saying, lots of gaps on this leg side where you can turn what looks like a 1 into a 2. And the Bears exploiting that well. Contact straight down the ground though from Ollie Stone. 125 for 8. Seems to catch the bottom of the bat that time. Nightfall starting to descend across Edgbaston. The lights well and truly in full effect. Short. It was cool there for a wide, but marked up as the one from the over.
Quite a brave delivery, that, I'd say. I'll call it brave with fine leg and third man and back point all up on the circle. That's, I have to say, I think he might have got away with one there. I'm not sure he meant it to be quite where he let it go, but yeah, Jake Lintott, unfortunately, just missing out on that one.
Final ball of Van der Guttenspel. Coming round the wicket. And Lintott trying to reverse paddle round the corner again. We talk about brave bowls. That was a brave shot to play. Bearing in mind where Van der Gutten's been pitching some of these deliveries. But he's grabbed himself another wicket, caught by Chris Cook. Lintott is gone for seven. And with 12 balls remaining, the Bears are 125 for nine.
Yeah, he does like that shot, Jake Lintott. He generally plays it fairly well, but I can't help but feel that perhaps this over with the shorter boundary on the leg side might have been the one to target, really go after, and then obviously you're going to go after the last over anyway. So the last ball of that over, I think, with the short boundary on the offside, maybe trying a little bit too much there, I think. But, you know, that's the game. If he hits that off the bat and it beats third man, short third man, bounces away for a boundary, then you know, you sing your praises. So that's the way it's played. You've got to be brave enough to try it, but he didn't quite get it right on that occasion. So just the one wicket left and 12 balls remaining. Jeetan Patel probably going to do more batting in T20 than he's probably done the last couple of years combined, I would think, at this stage.
Well, he's out there. Final man, two overs to go. Stone gets it into the covers. Quick single. Brings Jeetan on strike, 126 for nine. He's probably thinking to himself, look, I could just have a nice relaxing final season. I'll turn my arm over a bit, and yet here he is once more.
No, in the middle. Hear those words from Jeetan Patel, nice relaxing. He'll be absolutely up for this, don't you worry.
Decent contact, he's going to have to make his ground here. Shy at the stumps was wide. He's off the mark. Still think 140 will be the target from here. To do that, though, they're going to need some boundaries. Surely Ollie Stone's the man. He's into double figures. 10 balls remaining. Certainly swung the bat at it. Good block in the end from De Langer.
He hasn't really quite timed one yet. Ollie, it'd be interesting if you can get a hold of a couple in this over and give them a bit of a free hit in the last set.
Outside edge of the bat, just a single. 8 balls remaining. 128 for nine. These final five fixtures, of course, three are here at Edgbaston with Worcester and North Hants next weekend, Friday and Sunday. Short ball. And Jeetan Patel can get nothing on that. And De Langer with one more ball to come. This is final over, just three singles off the over so far. He's gone for 22 as well. This one's fuller. It's a full toss, and it's played out by Jeetan Patel. Onto the boundary for just the one. 129 for nine then, with one over remaining. Patel on two, and Stone on 11. And again, a final over here with a bit of momentum can really help when you go into the field as well, can't it?
Yeah, it can. I mean, they're going to have to get what they can off these six balls, and you know, it's time to try and find some boundaries. But as you say, if they manage to do that, they can get themselves a little bit of momentum to take in with the ball. But either way, I think they're going to be looking to take wickets early and really, really fire up the bowlers, who hopefully aren't too tired from having to do so much batting. It's more than they used to in these fixtures.
And they'll be giving it plenty, won't they, as well? They were, you know, when they'll be pointing out to the batsmen that they've been working hard for on their behalf.
Yeah, I think there'll be a little bit of chuntering, but no, they'll know what their job ahead is, and you know they'll be fired up to make sure that they do a great job with the ball as well. But it's important that we get absolutely everything we can out of these last six deliveries.
And it's Rory Smith who will close the innings for Glamorgan. Long handle from Jeetan Patel, straight down the ground. It's just going to be a single. Ollie Stone was looking for a second. Stone now maybe with an opportunity. And Jeets just wanders down the wicket to talk to him. Will Jeets be keen on this run in, or thinking, look, Ollie, just sit back and give it a good crack?
Yeah, I think he quite fancied five boundaries off the last five deliveries here, to be honest. But throughout that was the conversation. You know, it's ones or boundaries, that's all we're doing.
Wouldn't we all? Clever change from Rory Smith into the wicket. Slower ball bouncer. And Ollie Stone way through the shot before the ball even reached him.
Yeah, I would expect pace off these last four balls or very straight with this field. He's got all of his fielders up on the offside behind the wicket and at mid-off as well. So I'd expect if you're trying to make Ollie Stone hit to the longer boundary over here, where they've already taken a catch or two, Glamorgan, so they'll be hoping to get one out there. But obviously a little bit wet. Got something stuck on his shoe there.
Oh, that's a cracking hit from Ollie Stone. That's all the way for six. Baseball style. It's a terrific strike. The short ball again, wide outside off stump and well dispatched.
Yeah, it's a beauty from Ollie Stone. He's struck that beautifully. A little bit slower again, but giving himself a bit of room. Throwing his hands through that. And I mentioned earlier he's been having a little bit of trouble timing the ball. He hasn't really found the middle of the bat, but he got absolutely everything on that one. That was a fantastic shot. Well in front of square as well. He'll be quite pleased with that, I'm sure.
He's on to 17. 136 for 9. Three balls remaining. Smith in again. Full toss again. It's driven away this time. Doesn't pierce the inner field. We're hoping to pick up on a missed field, but it's just a single and a rock back of the head from Ollie Stone. He's frustrated, I think, that the full toss wasn't dispatched better.
Yeah, he hit it pretty well. Just didn't quite find the gap. Again with this field, it's a very risky place for Smith to be bowling. But I'm sure Jeetan Patel will be looking the same, looking to that offside. Maybe give himself a little bit of room here.
Two balls remaining. Smith in again. Cracked away by Jeetan Patel. Sounded good. Made really good contact, but he's picked out the fielder. On the cover boundary. Just the one. 138 for 9 then with one ball to go. Ollie Stone is talking to the umpire and he's having a good look around the field trying to pick his spot. What do we reckon? Slow again into the wicket?
I would imagine so.
It's full up and Ollie Stone has found the gap. That's a terrific hit for four again through the covers from Ollie Stone. Gave himself some room. And maybe, just maybe, has given the Bears a chance here. 142 for 9 at the end of the 20 overs, Tim Ambrose.
Yeah, great work from Ollie Stone at the end. We mentioned one big over at least in those last three or four, even with the wickets and the damage that's been done. And Oliver Stone really delivered there. That was very, very fine hitting. And they've given the Bears a chance, that's for sure. 142 have to bowl very well, but it's there. They're on the board.
22, Ollie Stone finishes on. Jeetan Patel on 4. DeLanger there, none for 23, was his bowling figures at the end. Let's just run you through the card quickly then. Dom Sibley was the first man out without scoring. In fact, first ball, he was caught and bowled off the bowling of Prem Sisodia. He was soon followed by Ed Pollock, out for 12, caught by Cook off the bowling of Van de Gooten. Adam Ho scored 23. He was caught by Smith off the bowling of Salter. And Sam Hain was out LBW to Rory Smith for 3. Will Rhodes top scoring with 46 before he was run out. Van de Gooten doing the fielding on that one. Michael Burgess went for 9, caught on the boundary by Taylor off the bowling of Salter. Tim Bresnan was out off the bowling of Sisodia for one. Henry Brooks scoring 14 before out to Van der Gooten, and Ollie Stone finishing on 22 not out. Jake Lintott out for seven, again off Van der Gooten, and Jeetan Patel finishing on four. 142 for nine then, 143 to win the game for Glamorgan when they return. In a moment, Becky will be back here to recap that first innings, but first of all, let's have a look at this.
Chilly, so it's certainly big coats weather, not really cricketing conditions, although the weather is set fair and we haven't got rain, so that is something. The Bears 142 for nine, needing 143 to win, and with Brian Halford, club journalist. Brian, are the Bears going to be happy with that?
They're going to have to be, aren't they? I think they would have hoped for a good 20 or 30 more than that when they chose to bat, but a bit of late impetus there from Ollie Stone. Mm-hmm. Really good innings, 22 from 18 balls at the end, has given them something to bowl at. Great knock from Will Rhodes, 46 from 31. Pivotal moment of the innings, perhaps that run out. Rhodes and Brooks were just building a nice partnership there when Henry called for a very difficult second run, and Rhodes was run out for 46, his career best in T20, and he was looking good to add a lot more.
Yeah, he'll be disappointed with that, I imagine, not quite getting his half century.
He played really well, really good, well organised innings, because he'd come in at 33 for 3 with the Bears in trouble and was playing a really good captain's knock, working it around well, the occasional big hits as well, so it was looking good. But one moment in T20 can change the whole game, can't it? And that left the Bears rebuilding again.
Important work from the skipper, steadying the ship there. Now, in your time, Brian, you have met some tremendous batsmen. You've seen quite a few out there. Ian Bell, where does he stand for you in those rankings?
Belly stands very close to the top, if not the top of the guys I've seen play for Warwickshire. Kumar Sangakkara was a great player, of course. Ian Belly's up there. As we all know, Belly had the ultimate trademark of class, of making a very, very difficult game look very easy. He was a great player. I was speaking to Belly earlier this week and about his career. We're going to do a series of big interviews on the Bears website with him in the next few weeks. And I did say what his farewell message to the Bears members and supporters would be, and he just says thank you. He just wants to thank the Bears members for all their support, and he said he hopes he's given a bit of pleasure to them along the way. Well, I think he did, didn't he?
Yeah, I'm sure he did. Thank you very much, Brian. A Warwickshire player through and through, a Birmingham Bear, right the way to the core. Let's take a little look about Ian Bell as he made his huge announcement this week that he's retiring.
Ian, it wasn't meant to be for the Bears, but that was an incredible finale, wasn't it?
It was absolutely brilliant. It's been a brilliant 4 days for us, really. I think, you know, coming here, losing the toss on a you know, very green wickets. So we've had the rough end of the conditions, but to come out on top with a very young side as well that we've put out as well is a brilliant effort and a nice way to finish. In a way, it'd be nice for a win, but it's been a good way, but also a good way to finish the season on a bit of a high. We could have actually sat here with really 3 wins out of the 5 games we've played, but this one's probably been our best performance by a way.
How's the day been for you?
It's been great. I've enjoyed it. You know, I think, like I said, I've come into the game quite relieved in a way. It's the right decision physically. I know that with my body, and it's just nice to come out and put in a performance, you know, to finish. And it was close to, I suppose, being able to get a win. But again, some great experience. You know, like I said, for me, a great way to finish. But on the flip side, you know, a great way for some of our other lads to start. You know, in this game, there was 2 19-year-olds playing, a 20-year-old, you know, and the rest of the guys are about 25. So like the age bracket of this group is young. So again, it's getting into the habits of days like that. You know, it would have been nice to get over the line because that experience for our young guys and winning, you know, it becomes a habit. But days like that is a good day for like this young group.
God of Honor walking on the pitch, you left the pitch on your own to an applause. Has there been any emotion since all that's happened?
I know, I felt pretty calm. Whether it will change in the next couple of weeks, I know there's a bit of T20 still to go, but I just feel that it's the right time. So I don't really feel, I think in the 22 years I've been with Warwickshire or more, you know, since I was a kid, but you know, I've given everything I've got, so it's just feel like the right time. Batting was okay, running and fielding is a bit different, but yeah, just pleased with the performance we've put in, and I can move on now knowing that, like I said, some good young players and hopefully we'll be going forward.
You mentioned those runs, 140 in the game, 90 in the second inning. You'd be pleased as well with that impact as well with the bat.
100%. You know, if you'd have told me I was going to get 90 on this pitch at the start of the day, I would have taken it with both hands. So it was nice to get out there, nice to put us in a position to try and win a game of cricket. And I thought the 4 days, like I said, has been a fantastic day for this team. You know, and a great way to finish.
And now into the T20, mate, you'd love to go back to Edgbaston and play again.
Oh, 100%. Yeah, it'd be nice to get one more game at Edgbaston. Slight little niggle from this game, in a way, was a bit frustrating. But yeah, look, I'm looking forward to being in a good place actually in the T20. Some exciting cricket to come. You know, some guys who are fresh, not played in this game, have been training and raring to go. So yeah, exciting week or so for the club.
Well, I'm joined back in the Bears Den here with another Bears legend, Tim Ambrose. Tim, firstly, I can't talk to you about that yet without talking about Belly. Huge announcement this week. What do you make of it?
Yeah, it's. I mean, what a career. It's so difficult to put into words what Ian Bell's done for Warwickshire and for England and for the game in general in this country. But, I mean, it's obviously a decision. I think, as Brian said earlier, everyone who spoke to him, he seems very, very comfortable with it now and just really, really enjoying the experience of being able to sort of soak up all the last 20, 22 years he's had of memories. And as I say, I'm sure it's a very emotional time for him and his family.
It is. It's a big year for the Bears because not only is Belly now retiring, you and Jeets as well. It's a transitional time, isn't it?
Yeah. The old boys are being moved on, I think. Well, you know, that's certainly how it works out. But that's and I think we've known that's been coming for a little while. So I'm sure the club's you know, more than prepared for this situation.
There's going to be a lot of testimonials coming up. Okay, so out there tonight, 1 for 2 for 9. What do you make of the performance?
Yeah, it's not ideal. It's not what they would have wanted. They certainly would have wanted more, as Brian said. But you know, perhaps some sloppy dismissals in there, some soft ones that you guys won't be too pleased with. But that's T20 cricket. You have to keep going. You have to keep trying to clear the ropes and being positive. So you know, at least they did that all the way down. And you know, even Ollie Stone at the end there, you know, played really well. But you know, the one thing we have seen from the two games has been the energy in the field. I think the Birmingham Bears have been fantastic in the field. They've been running around, throwing themselves around, plenty of noise, plenty of energy. You know, we talk about controlling controllables, and that's one thing you can control. And we've done that really well. So that's been a good sign, and I'd expect them to maybe even have to go a little bit further tonight to try and defend that title.
Yeah, well, it looks like we're all getting ready and gearing up for play to start out there on the field. Don't forget, you can still be part of tonight, even though you're not here. Make sure you download the app. It's free on iOS and Android. and put your pictures of your Bears Den on the photo wall. Thank you very much, Tim. I'm going to let you go because I think you've got more commentary to do.
Yeah.
We're getting Thank a money's worth out of you tonight. stick around in the Bears Den. And I'll hand over now to Adam Bridge and your commentary team for the second innings.
And we see David Lloyd, who is opening up for Glamorgan. First game of the campaign. Terrific start from Tim Bresnan. Decent length, good pace. Safely through into the hands of Michael Burgess. So not opting immediately to go for a spin option from that far end. Bresnan with the ball in hand. 142. For nine, so 1-4-3 the target here for Glamorgan. Outside edge of the bat, going to be cut off though, and cut off incredibly well. They'll just get a couple, but it's only one in the end for David Lloyd. Foot injury has kept the all-rounder out. Big part of this Glamorgan side usually. And Nick Salmon is on strike. Brian Halford's coming alongside me. And it's imperative to make a really, really good start with the ball.
That's right. Early wickets is what the Bears need.
On the mark again, Bresnan.
There are lots of wicket-taking bowlers in the Bears attack. Ollie Stone, of course. Tim Bresnan taking wickets in all formats at the very top level. And, of course, Jeetan Patel. So the Bears are very much in this game, but they do need to keep new batsmen at the crease for as much as possible.
41 for 3 was the score at the end of the power play for the Bears. And as we know, those wickets are crucial. I'm going to make a 2 here. This well-timed shot into the leg side from Selman. He's off the mark. Glamorgan are on to 3. And once again, there are gaps you can exploit. Turns those ones into twos. Still needing just over 7 and over, of course. Very crisp sound off the middle of Selman's bat, but well picked up that time by Jake Lintott. Just 3 off the over so far. A good opening over from Tim Bresnan. It's a lovely drive from Selman. And the last ball of the over goes for 4. 7 for no wicket. At the end of the first 6 deliveries from Tim Bresnan, and that actually will be a satisfactory start from Glamorgan's side.
I think that's just what Glamorgan will try and do, just keep wickets intact, and if they can just pop off a boundary one per over for them, well, they're just about there, aren't they? I mean, that will do, because they bowled well and they've restricted the Bears to a lowly total. Interesting strategy of the Bears to open with pace, isn't it? Now we've got Ollie Stone from the pavilion end. Now, obviously, we all know how destructive he can be. And if he can rip out a couple early on, then suddenly it'll be Glamorgan under pressure.
Well, it's up. It's whether a fielder can get there, and this just can't quite make it off that third man boundary. A huge swipe from David Lloyd at Ollie Stone's first ball. But it's just landed safely.
Yes, it would have been an extremely good catch by Ed Bullock. I'm not sure whether he got his hands underneath it. Swirling the ball swirling around up there in the night sky. And that would have been a great breakthrough. Not quite.
Ollie Stone again, and once more, Lloyd has had a swipe at that one. That's gone all the way for 6, though. He's cut it away. And the point boundary rope is just bypassed. Wasn't by much. But it's gone all the way for six. The question was asked. Lloyd's on nine. And they're on 15 without loss after just eight deliveries. Oh, again, just past the despairing dive of the fielder in the covers. Looking to try and get there. I think it may have been Henry Brooks that time, was it? Or was it Sam Hain, I think? Didn't get too far away. Dom Sidley's the one who's fetching it from the boundary, but it's another four.
Well, Di Lloyd is just throwing his hands at everything, and he's chancing his arm and getting away with it. Fair play to him. That one just out of the reach of cover. Earlier in the over, just short of third man, but he's getting away with it.
This is a good ball from Ollie Stone. Looked an angry response, that one. And there's a few words afterwards as well. We don't mind that, do we, Brian?
Well, I don't know what Ollie was saying there, but I think Di Lloyd can take it. He's just back from a broken foot, David Lloyd, and he sustained a broken foot in a recent match and still finished the over with it when he was bowling. So he's made of stern stuff, his Di, so he can take a bit of Ollie's sledging, I think.
Slip coming out.
They need a wicket, Adam, don't they?
Oh, and it was a good call from Ollie Stone as well, because that's a terrific stop by Tim Bresnan. Although the question is, what damage has he done to his hand? Because that was hit incredibly hard. And he's still down, and he's a good Yorkshire lad, so he's not the sort that'll stay down if that didn't hurt.
Yeah, and one of his colleagues has just been over to say, how are you doing? And Brez has just got up, and although he doesn't look in a great deal of comfort there, does he? He's just wringing his hand though, and you think he's going to be good to go again.
It's his left hand. It's a chilly evening, so it probably would have left a bit of an impression, but it was well struck. He did grab a single off it. Selman on to strike. He's on six. Lloyd's on 14. Last ball of Ollie Stone's first over is a short one and over the top as it's ducked under by Selman. Terrific pace from Ollie Stone. But it was negotiated well by Glamorgan. 20 without loss at the end of the second over. And a reminder, we want to see photos of you watching the Bears from home. We're in our Bears den. So how about you download the Edgbaston app and upload to the photo wall for your chance to be named tonight's Scrivens Fan of the Match and tag us in on social media as ever using the hashtag BearsDen. Bresnan's going to bowl a second over. So this is a completely different strategy to Glamorgan. They went in with the two spinners, but the Bears are going in with pace.
Yeah, I think the plan must be to hopefully knock a couple over with pace and then for the spinners to impose a stranglehold later on.
Second over from Bresnan. That's going to be guided down to Ward's third man, where it's fielded on the boundary by Pollock. Just the single. 21 without loss. Lloyd is on to 15. Selman back on strike.
T20, a game of fine margins, as we know. Lloyd at the moment, all the fine margins are going in his favour. A couple of ones that could easily have been caught in that first over, but weren't.
Well, he's out of hoik here at Bresnan. That one's gone up in the air, under the lights as well. And it's safely pouched this time round. Good catch taken by Ollie Stone. And that's the end of Selman. He's gone for six. And Glamorgan have lost their first wicket. The Bears have struck 21 for one.
Yes, a good ball from Bresnan. That's a sort of accurate, good length ball that makes a batsman take a big risk if he wants to score runs off it. Selman did take a risk. And it's a well-judged catch by Ollie Stone. Not easy looking into one of the great big lights there. And he made it look quite comfortable. And that's the breakthrough that the Bears needed. 21 for one. And there's still plenty of cricket left in this game, Adam. They just need to keep those wickets falling.
Batsman entering the fray for Glamorgan. I understand it'll be Andy Balburnie. They are obviously coming in from the far end, the Birmingham end, where their dugout is under the COVID measures here. And obviously the batsman crossed anyway. So Lloyd will be on strike. Bresnan's got his first of the night. And as we talked about earlier, wickets in this power play, absolutely crucial. And the Bears have their first. Quite defensive that from Lloyd. We're not used to seeing that.
These are the two batsmen that Glamorgan will look to potentially play a match-winning innings. So a couple of breakthroughs here for the Bears. And it's a very different game. But this is a good over from Bresden so far. He's bounced back from taking that stinging blow in the field with a really good over so far.
Short ball. I think Lloyd trying to make the point. No, it's been given as a no ball. For head height. I think Lloyd made the point as well there, just to try and emphasise to the umpire that that ball was too short from Tim Bresnan. He's only little right. though, isn't he?
Sorry?
He's only little, Mr. Lloyd.
It is, yeah. He is, that's right.
Oh, you've got all of that, though. Backward a square. Six runs again for Lloyd. It's a big hit. 29 for one now, Glamorgan.
Well, I think I did put the mockers on Bresnan here, didn't I? It's... just playing tribute to him and drags two down. One is a no ball and the other one is short. And Lloyd voraciously onto it, swings it into the Ragland stand.
That's Fuller, strikes him on the pad. He'd gone down to try and sweep that away from Tim Bresnan. But a precious dot ball in this format of the game, of course. 29 for one. Interesting to see whether they persist with Ollie Stone at this pavilion end or whether we may well see the first introduction of spin potentially. Fall from Bresnan and he's got him. Has he caught him on the fall? Lloyd has gone for 21 and that's a terrific breakthrough right at the end of the third over from Tim Bresnan. He's got his second. And Lloyd, the danger man, is on his way. Terrific strike.
Well, a pretty eventful over that. A wicket at the start and the end of it. Two big ones. Lloyd, 21 from just 12 balls. So he was doing damage, but it was... I thought for a moment it was a bump ball. It was just squeezed off his toes by Di Lloyd. And very sharply picked up there by Dom Sibley at mid-wicket. Very adroit catch, that. And 29 for two, knocking good, so good for Glamorgan. The Bears sticking in here. That's which is what you have to do in T20. There are times in every game when it's really going against you. And you've just got to stick in and be patient and be resilient. At the moment, the Bears are doing that. 29 for two from three overs.
The captain's in, Chris Cook, to join Andy Balburnie. Neither batsman faced a ball yet. And really, he probably don't want to face Jeetan Patel straight away, but he's coming on at this pavilion end for the Birmingham Bears. It's the wickets that the key in the power play. As we say, if you lose three wickets, you very rarely win a game. But if both teams lose three wickets, in my logic, that's game on.
Could be a tie.
Right on the money, immediately from Jeetan Patel. Bowling here to Balburnie, Irish international. Played in that recent series of games against England. Just helps that into the leg side. He's off the mark.
Jeetan Patel, the Bears' top T20 wicket taker by a mile. 139 wickets he's got in the format for the Bears. 58 above Neil Carter, who's second.
Immediately, Jeetan Patel just applying the brakes and the pressure to this Glamorgan side. Straight to the man at short fine leg. There, primarily you feel for that fine sweep as well. No run again, just one run off the first four balls. of this opening over from Jeetan Patel. Oh, he's appealing for pad first. I mean, there was certainly some bat afterwards. And he just holds his pose for a few moments, Jeetan Patel. As if the umpire's going to change his mind. Terrific over from Jeetan Patel. Just the one run from it. 30 for two now. And Bresnan removed the two openers and Patel's followed it up with a really tight over, which is just what was needed.
Absolutely was. And suddenly just pressure starting to swivel back towards Glamorgan, who of course badly need to win this game if they're going to qualify in the T20. So if the Bears can just squeeze them a little bit, then let's see what the pressure will do. Tim Bresnan, 2 for 16 from two overs. He's going to have a third.
Don't often get three in a row in T20, but Bresnan is. Having taken those two wickets, I suppose it's a risk worth taking at this point.
And of course, who knows, he did take a very, very stinging blow on the hand in the field. And there may be a case that he just wants to get his bowling done in case that stiffens up and becomes really painful. But he's bowling well enough to justify a full spell at the minute anyway.
Great stop by Jeetan Patel. Short extra cover.
Just one run from the last, or two runs from the last nine balls.
You can hear the chatter out in the field, can't you, about the dot balls keeping the pressure on. Another single, just turn around the corner. They won't mind that though, midway through the fifth over, 32 for two. Wickets and dot balls the key when you're defending a modest total. 143 the target for Glamorgan. 111 required. Just be a single. Off the edge of the bat of Andy Balperny. He moves on to three.
Very key partnership this for Glamorgan. Di Lloyd was one of the big guns. Skipper Cook, a lot of experience. He'll be playing here for Birmingham Phoenix, of course, next year in the 100. And Balperny is a match winner. So these are the guys that the Bears have got to squeeze and hopefully dismiss.
He hasn't got all of that. He's got the toe end of the bat and he's going to be out. Oh, he's dropped it. Catch is dropped. It was in the air for a long time. Difficult under these lights with the night sky as well. I think that's Adam Hose that's put that opportunity down. That could have been Tim Bresnan's third wicket and really would have put the cat amongst the pigeons for Glamorgan.
Yeah, Adam Hose, one of the safer pairs of hands in the Bears team, but that was a poor one.
Dot ball to end the over. Three overs gone. 2 for 20 for Tim Bresnan. 34 for two then at the end of five overs. And a lifeline given to Glamorgan. Jeetan Patel will bowl his second over. The final one of this power play. Tim Ambrose is coming in alongside me. And it's not like Adam Hose to put down chances like that.
No, very surprising. Usually, as you say, very, very good pair of hands. Usually very safe in the outfield as well. That was perhaps done him for a little bit of lack of pace. But yeah, big shame though.
That's a terrific shot from Chris Cook, captain and wicketkeeper in this Glamorgan side. Just rocked back, a little short from Jeetan Patel, and is dispatched through the covers for four. They won't want to release the pressure they've built up here. sometimes that moments like that drop catch can just do that.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more. They're still trying to keep themselves going out there. There's plenty of noise and plenty of energy, but you know, in part that delivery is down to Jeet Patel, probably not quite back on it. Still a little bit disappointed about that drop chance.
Just a single. Sam Hain doing the fielding. To sneak one more wicket now. We'll just give him that lift. Score's almost in parity at this point. The only difference as we stand is in that wickets column.
Yeah, again, very important over this, and no surprise to see Will Rose turn to Jeet and Patel to bowl this last over the power play. Oh,
and he's stumped him. Well, he thought he had Michael Burgess. Terrific piece of glove work. But the umpire not interested. Celebrations had started. There's a rub of the ground in frustration from Jeet and Patel.
Yeah, great work from Michael Burgess there. Doing his best to bluff the square leg umpire as well. I'm sure he knew he was probably still in, but you never know.
See if keepers do that.
I never said that.
They'll grab another single, and that's going to be the end of the power play. Another good over from Jeet and Patel. Two overs for 9 so far. 42 for 2 then. It's where Glamorgan find themselves at the end of the power play. Of course, the Bears were 41 for 3 at this point. So just the extra wicket, the difference. But in terms of runs scored, it's been a tough start for them as well.
Yeah, I think that catch is held. It's certainly honours even, I think, in my opinion. But, you know, you've got the two best batters in the Glamorgan side in now. So this is a big partnership for them in what is a must-win game as well. So the Bears will still be hoping to put plenty of pressure on them, and hopefully they can get a mistake or force an error from the Glamorgan team. But Tim Bresnan is going to bowl his fourth over out now.
And do we think Tim's bowling through just because of that hand problem, maybe, with the left hand?
It's possible. I think he took one on that left thumb at Worcester in the 4-day game a few weeks ago. But they can create sort of bone bruising that can take a long time to heal. And when you get another one there, that can be quite uncomfortable. So it is possible that he's going to bowl this and go and get some ice on his thumb.
Just a single to Bow Burney. He moves on to 6. Both wickets to Bresnan so far. Should have had a third. Field spread, of course, now. We're out the power play. There's two boundary riders on either side of the wicket. Well, there again is the appeal that Bresnan had got a fingertip on that one to touch it onto the stumps, but I think he was in his ground anyway there, Andrew Balburney.
Yeah, such a canny bowler, Tim Bresnan. Just the subtle changes of pace. Not complete slower balls, but just little few mile per hour change each delivery, making it very hard for the batsman to time it.
Cook comes down and just turns that one round the corner and does it very well. Pulls it for 4. Aggressive from Cook that time. They're just feeling the squeeze a little bit in this over from Bresnan.
Yeah, Bresnan perhaps looking for a repeat of the chance that went up out to Adam Hose out there in his previous over. It was a very similar delivery, but stayed on top of it that time, Cook, and got himself 4 runs.
That's going to be out, and it is. He's gone, and that's what it means to Tim Bresnan. They've got the wicket of Chris Cook. It's an excellent catch, and he's on his way for 12 off 12 balls. And this really is game on it.
Yeah, what a big wicket that is. He's been excellent for Glamorgan this campaign, Chris Cook. And Tim Preston, obviously, there's a lot of fire and passion in that celebration. He really, really wanted that one. I guess he felt he deserved. But again, that just that subtle mix of pace, getting it to stick in the wicket, such a clever bowler. Obviously, so much experience coming to the fore there, and that is a big wicket. I think that really does level things up. So the Bears really staying in the fight here and making sure they're keeping Glamorgan under pressure. As I say, it would be considered a must-win game for them. So, you know, they have a little bit of pressure to work with. They have to keep trying to squeeze now.
Well, we're seeing Marchant de Lange coming out to face for Glamorgan. We had him down as number 8 on the card, but clearly they feel that they need to try and get some momentum going here, which can be the case when you're chasing such a small target, can't it?
Yeah, it's a very interesting tactic. I don't know if it was premeditated before the game or they've just decided it for this innings, but it's interesting.
The last ball of his spell from Tim Bresnan. It'll go for a single. And that's 4 overs. And he's taken all 3 wickets and 26 runs for Tim Bresnan. And it wouldn't surprise us if at this point... Is he going to depart? No. He's staying out there. So maybe it was just purely a tactical thing while he was looking dangerous and looking to take wickets to try and make that happen.
Yeah, it looks as though he and Will Rhodes... fancied getting those 4 overs in, and it was a fantastic decision by the pair of them. Yeah, got to give some credit to Will Rhodes there. He's kept him on, fancied him for another wicket. We've spoken about how important the wickets are, and he's delivered. He's delivered for his skipper there. So, you know, a chance to get back into the spin now with a new batsman in de Lange, who can hit an extremely large ball, and one of the bigger hitters around. But no one's really been able to get a hold of the spinners tonight, so it'll be interesting to see how Jake Lintott gets on here.
Lintott bowling from the pavilion end. Full toss with his first delivery. It's well fielded. There's no run. Will Rhodes with a stop. 48 for 3. Oh, and he's got him. De Lange has gone. Caught and bowled by Lintott. 48 for 4. And all of a sudden, Glamorgan find themselves in real trouble. It's a terrific catch. Caught and bowled by Lintott. That was really hammered back at him. He's done incredibly well there, Tim.
Yeah, what a great find he's been for the Bears this year, Jake Lintott. A lot of people have spoken about him. He deserves a lot of credit for his strength of character and his commitment to get himself this opportunity this year, and he is absolutely making the most of it. That was fantastic. Really great grab from him there. As I say, de Lange hits a very hard ball, and he's clung onto it well above his head. It's a really good catch, and as you say, that's really got the Bears back in this game, and they're in pretty good shape at the moment, I'd say. They seem to have a lot of momentum out there. We've spoken about that all night, and I think... They'll fancy themselves from this position if they can keep putting the squeeze on. I'd say a lot of pressure on Balburnie, who's very experienced and a very fine player, but he's going to have to do a lot of work to guide this innings home, I think.
Owen Morgan, the new batsman. Oh, and he's gone for a stumping again this time, but once more, the umpire having none of it. But it does just put the pressure on. It's a reminder, particularly to Morgan, that if he steps outside that crease, there's every chance that Michael Burgess is on top of him.
Yeah, perhaps a little too eager there. Michael Burgess almost threw the ball back onto those stumps. He was so keen to get the bails off.
Good over so far from Lintott. He's beaten him again outside the off stump. 4 dot balls and a wicket in this over so far. Or 3 dots and a wicket, should I say. Continuing his impressive form so far, Jake Lintott. A little bit shorter this time. Just allowed Morgan to get onto the back foot. And takes the single. 49 for 4. 1 ball remaining in the 8th over.
Still keeping the slip in as well, Will Rhodes. Still attacking. Looking to keep catches in. Try and take wickets. I know how important that's going to be to keep the pressure on this Glamorgan team.
Balburnie greets it on the full. They'll take a single. It'll bring up the 50 at the end of the eighth over. 50 for four then. Glamorgan, another 93 required to win from 12 overs. Now, we've had some fantastic entries in for our Scrivens Fan of the Match, and our winner is Mike McKenzie. So congratulations to you, Mike, and as part of our Scrivens Fan of the Match, you'll receive a new Bears T20 shirt and two tickets to a Bears game in 2021. Congratulations to you there, Mike, hiding behind the pillow already there, looking quite tense, but a terrific shot, and thanks for getting in touch. You are our Fan of the Match tonight. Right, change then. Bresnan's bowled through his four overs, of course, at the Birmingham end. And Henry Brooks then coming into the attack for the Bears. 50 for four here, Glamorgan. Straight on the mark. Tim Bresnan unable to field that cleanly. And they'll get themselves through for a single. Now Burnie's on to eight. Brings Morgan on to strike.
There. Tim Bresnan is in the walls a bit tonight. It's giving it a bit of a rub as well, so might need to get in the ice bath after this one.
It's a big shout from Henry Brooks. The fingers up alongside me, but not of the man that matters.
Yeah, quite like the look of that from up here.
We're not at a perfect angle, are we? But
well, I'm a wicket keeper. They're all out when you when you're feely.
I was going to say, you would, with the way that finger went up, you'd be a batsman's worst nightmare if you turned to umpiring, Tim.
I certainly would.
When you do retire. Brooks hitting the bat hard. Just a single. 52 for four. Midway through the ninth over.
Yeah, excellent length so far from Henry Brooks. He's been right on the money, giving himself a chance, bring the stumps into play. I think if there's any criticism early on to the Bears' quickies, they were a little bit too short, ball disappearing square of the wicket, not forcing the batsman to hit down the pitch. So he's been right on the money here so far.
Straight to Bresnan. Seeing plenty of the ball, Tim Bresnan, tonight. Would have been good to have seen him across a full season, really, wouldn't it, Tim Bresnan, his arrival?
Yeah, much to look forward to, I think. And very shrewd signing from Warwickshire and Birmingham, and he's come in with a point to prove by the look of it as well. I think he's been a fantastic player so far in this limited season that we've had. So, yeah, much to look forward to for the fans here, that's for sure.
Brooks in again, finds the outside edge of the bat. Cheating Patel with a decent throw there. No need for it. They weren't running. Just two off the over so far with one ball remaining. A good start from Henry Brooks. They'd have gone into this, Glamorgan, feeling that it was probably a really gettable total, but overs like these just start to build that pressure with all these wickets down as well, don't they?
Yeah, that's exactly right. And I think, you know, really, really good start from Henry here. As I say, he's bringing those stumps into play. He's been bang on with the length. Told the batsman if they want to take a risk, that's up to them.
Slightly slower ball that time. Turned into the leg side by Bal Burnie. It's just another single, just three singles off the over as well. 53 for four then from nine overs, approaching the midway point of this Glamorgan innings. Four wickets down, one to Lintott, three to Bresnan. And the Bears very much in this. And we're doing our second player layer poll of today as well. And that's to predict today's winners. Simply enter on the Edgbaston app by scrolling down on the home tab and tell us who you think will win this evening from this point. 11 overs remaining. Glamorgan need 90 more and have six wickets in hand. Head to the app and give us your predictions right now. Here's Lintott for his second over. Just worked into the leg side. Hayne will field. Just managed to avoid landing that on the cover of that strip, just to the right-hand side as we look of the strip they're playing on this evening. An attempted reverse paddle around the corner there from Morgan.
Yeah, difficult shot on this angle for Morgan there. Ball always sort of sliding away from him. Slip could come into play with that option.
A good delivery from Lintott. Wasn't obviously in that squad for the first game here against Somerset that ended up being rained off. But certainly when they took on Glamorgan for the first time, he absolutely made an impact for the Bears.
Yeah, he's had a fantastic introduction. So he's been around the setup for a little while now, worked very hard on his game, really deserves his chance.
And it's stories like Jake's that are coming to the fore, with obviously some of the overseas players unable to come and join, Chris Green not able to come over. It just gives them this opportunity, doesn't it?
It does create an opportunity, and you know, that's one part of the story, and the other part is how well Jake's taken it as well. How well he's stuck to his task and believed in himself, and he's been a fantastic introduction.
And it's another terrific over. Two overs, no maiden, 1 for 4. From Jake Lintott so far, and the squeeze very much being applied here to Glamorgan. The midway point of their reply, they are 55 for 4. They require another 88 for victory here in this crucial game in the Vitality Blast at Edgbaston. And the second half of this innings, it's going to be a nail biter. You get the feeling. Henry Brooks is coming back for his second over from that Birmingham end. A wonderful view of the Birmingham skyline tonight. And I think, Brian, we're in for a tense old finish here.
Yes, it looks like a cracking game.
There's an outside edge there. And it's just going to be a single. Pollock is doing the fielding. He was in the air for a while. You just wonder for a moment if he might be able to get there, but it's one more run to the total.
Henry Brooks, of course, who spent some time with the England white ball setup earlier on this year, and I think the Bears are looking at him very much as a pressure bowler, as a death bowler now in the short formats.
A little shorter that time from Henry Brooks, and he's punished for it into the leg side by Andy Balburnie. That's a 4. And that pressure just released a little on the Irish international. They move on to 60 for 4.
Yes, Balburnie, a very experienced player, taking his time, 14 from 18 balls. He has got a bit of time, of course, because the Bears didn't make a great big total, but the Bears know that if they can get him, they really are in with a chance.
Sam Hain does the fielding, as he so often does, as the boundary rider on the offside. Morgan, another short-looking fellow from this Glamorgan side. And they've stolen a very quick single there. That's all about the backing up of Balburnie, because Morgan didn't have a clue when that had gone, as it came off his gloves and went probably over his head, I think, in the end. But Balburnie had already started his run and called him through, and that's a bit of a cheeky single.
No, exceptional running, wasn't it? Because he was, all the danger was for Balburnie, but he was very, very quick off the mark, and he knew that only Henry Brooks was going to get to the ball, and Brooks couldn't possibly turn and throw down the stumps at the bowler's end. So that was really good work from Balburnie. He might not think it was quite so good if Brooks gets him out with this ball, though, of course.
Well, he's got some of that. He's got all of it. That's 6 runs. It's short from Henry Brooks and dispatched by Balburnie. And there was just for a moment as it left the bat, you thought one of those two fielders, Tim Bresnan being one of them out on that boundary, may well have had an opportunity, but that was very well hit.
Yes, it was, and it's not the longest boundary over that side, and quite unforgiving for any bowler that's dropped short, and that was a short delivery from Henry Brooks, and the ball ended up in the groundsman's tunnel.
That's Fuller, but straying maybe just onto the pads a little bit of Balburnie. Sneak through for another single. And that's the end of the over. And some of that pressure just released then. 69 for 4 now through 11. That's 74 more required here for Glamorgan in this crucial game in this Vitality Blast Central Group.
74 from 9 overs in many T20 games. That wouldn't seem too daunting, but this is a pitch on which runs have had to be hard earned. So the Bears still very much in this game, especially with Jeetan Patel still with 2 overs to deliver, and he's about to bowl his third now. Just 9 runs from his first 2 overs, and Patel to Balburnie, which is what I think it's going to be now, is it could be the match-turning duel.
Worked into the leg side by Balburnie. I'll take a single. 53 balls remaining, 73 runs to win. 6 wickets in hand, of course. That's the other factor that will come into play in this game. Still 3 overs to come from Ollie Stone, of course. Lintott with a couple to bowl as well. Wonder if we see Will Rhodes. You mentioned earlier you may well bowl well on this surface. That's a sweep that's going to get the better of Stone this time round. That's 4 runs for Balburnie. And it looks like he is the danger man, Brian.
Very much so, and he's played this well, actually. He was... He didn't do anything reckless early on. He just had a look, which is probably what you need to do in these conditions because it's not too easy batting out there. And he's now moved to 27 and he's looking very dangerous.
Well run single. Brings Morgan on to strike. Takes Balburnie on to 28. 76 for 4.
Morgan, actually, he's just got 5, which doesn't seem really very important, but they've stopped the rot, haven't they? They've just got a little partnership together here.
Well, they're appealing for a catch. Morgan's going nowhere. And the umpire is saying, not out. Oh, Purchase and Patel were absolutely convinced they had him then, but he stood his ground.
The umpire's just pointed to his hip, so I assume it was pad, which was what, because it must have hit something, or it would have been a wide, I think, down the leg side, wouldn't it? But a very confident shout from the Bears.
Jeetan Patel looking
very much need a wicket.
Very frustrated. Owen Morgan stood his ground, as did the umpire. Not out. Final ball of Jeetan Patel's third over, the 12th of the innings. Cut away. Be a single. And Ollie Stone discards his jumper and his cap, which is the sign that he's coming on from the Birmingham end to bowl the 13th over, 77 for 4, 66 required to win for Glamorgan.
Now this is going to be crucial, isn't it? Ollie Stone, a very, very fast bowler and potentially a destructive bowler, but of course the pace men can also come off the bat quite briskly. So in the next moments, I think this game is going to take a big jolt one way or the other. If he can blast out somebody, particularly Balburnie, then the Bears are right on top here.
13 runs off Ollie Stone's first over. Morgan is on strike. You can hear the cries of come on Stoney. And what's quite an eerie setting at this time of night. Sirens in the background as Stone's in. Just be a single. Ed Pollock does the fielding. 78 for 4. 65 required off 47 balls. Tim Bresnan being very vocal. And G'ing up the field. Will Rhodes and Ollie Stone in conversation. Balburnie's certainly the danger man. He's on strike here. He's on 28. wicket now would be so good for the Bears. Going to get a single here though. Didn't get much of it. Balburnie got enough to get it beyond Stone. Moves on to 29.
I think Ollie Stone there striving for the Yorker, which is a pretty devastating ball if you get it right. He nearly got it right. Just squeezed away there by Balburnie.
Beats Morgan outside the off stump. Full of length that time. Big swipe from Morgan. So many theories about how you bowl at the death in these games, isn't it? Is the Yorker a thing of the past? Is it now all about that short of a length ball that's just bowled into the surface and the change of pace? A good ball's a good ball, isn't it? And that's a great one from Ollie Stone.
A really good ball, isn't it? Yeah, the Yorker, of course, is a devastating delivery if you get it right. But I think it went a bit out of fashion because if you just get it slightly wrong or the batsman moves forward into it, you can flick it away and make it into a full toss, can't you? So it is a high-risk delivery as well. But then what delivery in 2020 isn't high-risk? It's a batter's game, isn't it?
I did hear an interesting idea. I think it was floated by Shane Warne the other day that you should give the bowlers maybe five overs. So just to try and even the contest up a little. Short from Stone. Up in the air. Underneath it. Takes the catch. And it's Morgan, the batsman, that out for seven. And a fifth wicket is down. 79 for five. And Ollie Stone has struck.
And that little bit of extra pace there, just catching out Morgan earlier on in the over. He tried a really quixotic little swish across the line against Stone, which is a big ask against a batsman of his pace, and he made no contact. This time we did get some bat on it, but just shanked it to mid-on, where this time Adam Hose made no mistake. Morgan 7 from 17 balls, which doesn't sound very important, but he did give Glamorgan's innings a bit of a partnership there with Balburnie, and they will feel that if Balburnie's there and somebody can just stay around with him long enough, they will win this game. But that's a big blow for the Bears to strike, and they've just got to keep, how many times are we going to say it, they've just got to keep taking these wickets, haven't they, because they have underperformed with the bat, probably 20 or 30 short. The bowlers are under pressure at the moment. They're doing okay.
Just two runs off the over and the wicket from Ollie Stone. And that's the thing, the pressure builds, doesn't it? They see just two singles off the first two balls, a couple of dots, and then all of a sudden they feel they need to go for something special.
Absolutely, and a new batsman has got to now acclimatise, and always or usually brings a dot ball or two again. But the batsman crossed, so it's Balburnie to face.
Callum Taylor is the new batsman. Oh, there was a shy there, and Balburnie, I think, would have probably been in trouble. You can tell by the cries of anguish from the Bears fielders. That's a terrific over from Ollie Stone. A wicket and three runs from it. 80 for five. We have seven overs remaining here. 63 runs are required to win. And I think we're in for an enthralling finale, Brian Halford.
I think so, absolutely. Nine and over, which in many a T20 game you would think you would favour the batting side. But with five wickets down, this one is absolutely in the balance. And Jake Lintott is now coming on to deliver his third over. Two overs, one for four so far.
And well, Lintott could be quite key to this, couldn't he?
Sorry?
Lintott could be quite key to this.
Absolutely.
Good shot by Balburnie. Great stop by Jeetan Patel. Dot ball.
That's a nifty bit of fielding from a guy touching 40, isn't it?
I don't think I'd have been able to do that when I was touching 20, to be fair. He swept in, and he's going to be out! He is out! Balburnie's gone for 30. It's a terrific catch from Henry Brooks, the sweep off of Lintott, who gets his second wicket of the game. It's 80 for 6. It's Ollie Stone that took the catch. And that's terrific. And we said it, Brian, just keep taking the wickets.
Yeah, let's hear it for Will Rhodes as well, because he's brought Oliver Stone back on, and Stone struck a wicket with his in his first over, and now he's the captain's brought Lintott back on, and second ball, Balburnie goes for the big sweep, and Stone took a very good calm catch there, 80 for six. Two new batsmen have still to face. You don't get much newer than that. And they've got to acclimatise and get used to the light and the pitch. And all of a sudden, the Bears just a little bit on top here. Well, 63 needed.
Yeah, Andrew Salter that's come in to join Taylor. And it's going to be Callum Taylor who's on strike. He's only scored 44 runs in the competition so far this season. High score of 23. Good ball again from Lintott. 2 for 4, midway through his third over. You don't see figures like this in T20 cricket, really, do you?
Well, it's not bad from a guy that none of us expected to be playing for the Bears in T20 at all this year.
He's cut away. It's going to be stopped, is it? Oh, it's a terrific bit of fielding. Absolutely super stop out there from Henry Brooks. Well, I knew he was going to have impact somewhere in this over, and he has. Stopping two runs. Taylor's off the mark. He's on two. 82 for six. Oh, and he's bowled him. Lintott again. Taylor is gone. 7 down with 82 on the board. 61 more required for Glamorgan. And they've only got 3 wickets remaining. And Lintott's got his third. And that's a wonderful ball, a terrific piece of skill, and the Bears very much on top.
2.5 overs, no maidens, 3 for 6. That says it all about Lintott's work so far today. And as soon as Taylor went on the back foot there, I'm afraid he could have kept on going all the way, which he has done, because the ball skidded onto him. A really good piece of variation there from Lintott, and what a turnaround this is. 79 for 4 to 82 for 7. The Bears showing the resilience you need in T20 here, and also the skill. This is super bowling from the wrist spinner. 17 deliveries from Lintott, 3 wickets and 6 runs. And Glamorgan again have 2 batsmen at the crease who have yet to face a ball. And this is what the Bears need to do. This is what they are doing.
Smith is on strike and he gets off the mark. Up to long on, a single, 3 overs, no maidens, 3 for 7 for Jake Lintott. What a terrific contribution he's made. And that's 14 overs gone, 83 for 7 right now. Smith is on 1, Salter and naught. Of course, Salter, as we know, can be a little of a dangerous opponent, can't he, if we go back to finals day?
Absolutely. Yeah, there's work to do for the Bears still, because they didn't get a great big total, but 60 needed from 6 overs. It's gone up to 10 and over now. And Glamorgan are the ones under pressure.
As that Ollie wickets Stone, column is key, isn't it?
Absolutely. And all the specialist batsmen back in the hutch.
Ollie Stone then, third over. From the Birmingham end. And he's got a feather on it. No, he's not walking. Ollie Stone has appealed. Michael Burgess is convinced. But again, there's no walking on this occasion from Rory Smith, and the umpire not interested.
It seemed to be a bit of a sound, whether that one flicked the pad as well. But no walking. There's not too much walking these days, is there? As I suppose is reasonable, because there's so much video around. Just depend on that.
Not quite the spirit of the game, though, is it?
Would you walk?
I think I probably would still, yeah.
So would I.
I played cricket for the right reason.
Absolutely. Noble.
We are noble. We've got a conscience, haven't we, Brian? Stone in again. Oh, he's bowled it this time! You don't need the umpire. You don't need the outside of the bat for that. Off stump. Perfect ball from Ollie Stone. And Smith is on his way for 1. And Glamorgan are in all sorts of trouble here. 83 for 8 now. 60 still required. And the Bears surely are on their way to back-to-back wins.
Well, you see, that's what you get for not walking, isn't it? You get your off-stump knocked out off the next delivery.
It's karma, isn't it, Brian?
Absolutely. But great stuff from Ollie Stone. Could easily have got the wicket the previous delivery, so he responded with pretty much a fast Yorker, and it was much too good for Smith. Stone strikes again, and from 79 for 4, in this match being right in the balance, Glamorgan are 83 for 8, with just the tail in. As you say, Adam, there's still a couple of danger men, actually. Andrew Salter can bat, so can Tim van de Gutgen, who's just joining him. But the Bears now are really tightening their grip on this match. 83 for 8.
We'll say you never can really tell what a wicket's like until both teams have batted on it. Maybe it wasn't as easy as it looked in terms of the quality of it.
It just makes Will Rhodes' innings all the more important, doesn't it?
Stone in again. Full. Worked into the leg side. Tossed terrific bit of fielding. It's an absolutely super stop.
Did you think it was that good? I thought it was... I think it made it look a little bit more difficult than it was there. Am I being harsh there?
Listen, he's allowed to. 84 for 8. Stone coming in. Again, just knocked into the leg side. Just a single. 85 for 8.
Super over this from Ollie Stone. Very straight, very fast, giving the batsmen no scope to stretch their arms and swing their arms and get through the ball.
When you're going dot wicket 1-1 at this stage of the game, got plenty of that though. Has found a good. That's 4. 89 for 8, 54 still required.
That's the first one this over that Ollie has dragged down, and van de Gutgen was quickly onto it. He can hit hard, can Tim. So the Bears have got work to do yet.
31 balls remaining, 54 required. Nearly put that into the wicket, did Ollie Stone. It's a terrific over. Got himself another wicket. 89 for 8. And it's your chance now to vote for the 61 deep player of the match on our Twitter page at Warwickshire CCC. You can vote for our 61 deep player of the match. Cast your vote right now. Who has made the biggest contribution for the Bears tonight? I mean, we saw that 45 from Will Rhodes, which in the context of some of the innings we've seen from Glamorgan, I think probably just shows how good it was. The man with the ball in his hand right now, Jake Lintott, 3 for 7 from 3 overs. We've seen a terrific effort from Tim Bresnan bowling out with his 3 for 26. You can cast your vote right now. Head to our Twitter page as Lintott starts over 16. It's a full toss. It's hit straight back to him. Slight misfield. Michael Burgess is certainly alive there as he charges from behind the stumps. And Tim, well, things are looking a bit rosier than when you left us.
Yeah, what a fantastic turnaround. Absolutely brilliant performance from the Bears here. As Lintott comes in again. Yeah, they've really, really turned the screw on this one. It's been about the wickets. Lintott's obviously done an amazing job, as we've mentioned. And the wicket of Balburnie was the big one in that little passage of play there. A couple either side as well, but that was the big one. He was the man he was looking to guide it home for Glamorgan. And Lintott did for him with a bit of extra bounce, so... Yeah, in a very good position now, but as was mentioned, Birmingham batsman. As another one goes up deep.
Up in the air. Oh, he spilled it. It's another one that's gone down. That's three in the field that have gone down this evening. And it's taking those opportunities, as you say. They still have a chance here. Salter, we know, can clear the ropes. Do seem to have struggled to pick the ball up when it's been in the air for a long time tonight.
Yeah, the usual excuse is that I lost it in the crowd, but that's they're not going to be able to use that one tonight. So interesting to see what they come up with.
Dom Sibley responsible for putting that one down. It's not been his night, really. A on the money again from Lintott. One ball to come. 3 for 11 so far. 50 required from 25 balls. 4 off the over. Last ball from Lintott. And he's got him. Well, no, has he got him? Again. Well, not for the first time tonight. Michael Burgess is convinced he's either got a catch or a stumping. But the umpire not interested. And as we were saying earlier, no walking going on here. What a terrific spell of bowling that is from Jake Lintott. Absolutely wonderful. 93 is the score for 8 wickets. 50 required then off the final 4 overs. And Lintott with 3 for 11 from 4 overs. Not figures you see very often in Blast cricket.
No, he's absolutely turned the game on its head there, Jake Lintott. What a fantastic spell that is. Wickets coming at the other end, but a lot of that falls from the pressure caused by Lintott. You know, could very nearly have had 4 for 11 from 4 overs. That's a fantastic return on what I still believe is a fairly good wicket. So Henry Brooks started really well with the ball. Got it up, got a nice full length, nice and straight. Hopefully he can stick with that plan here.
Yeah, Brooks is back on. Just turn around the leg side. Fine, picked up a fine leg. Short fine leg, in fact. There's no run. 50 off the last 24 deliveries. The task is getting tricky for Glamorgan. 93 for 8 right now. Brooks from the Birmingham end. Slightly slower ball. It's going to be one. Salter on to strike. He's on 2. Van der Gutten on 9. We've seen that both can hit a good ball. We were obviously referring to semi-final in 2017 when Andrew Salter did the damage for Glamorgan that day. Brooks again. Well parried.
Yeah, they definitely have to keep their foot on it here, Birmingham. They can't, as you mentioned, you know, all these guys can bat. They can all hit a long ball and boundaries when they're needed. We saw what Ollie Stone did at the back end of the Birmingham innings, and need to make sure that we stay right on top of this and make sure if we can create another chance or two that we hang on to them. But a really good over so far from Henry. He's getting it right up there, nice and full. And I mean, the batsman can't get underneath it at the moment.
Slower ball bouncer, and it does the job. Nothing offered from Salter. Another dot ball from Henry Brooks. And our statistician, and our club journalist, Brian Halford, of course, who's been alongside us tonight, has pointed out that is Lintott's spell is the fourth most economic full spell for the Bears in T20 history, behind a couple from Ricky Clark and one for Chris Wokes, which in terms of what those guys have achieved in this form of the cricket, I think just tells you how good that spell was.
Yeah, that's an exceptional statistic there. Ricky Clark, he's usually bowling his 4 up front. And he did a fantastic job with that. But Jake Lintott right through the middle there with Glamorgan looking to accelerate. That was a real match turning 4 overs from him there. But Birmingham want to make sure they don't let him down here. They want to make sure that they get themselves over the line. There's still a bit of work to do. So
just 2 off the over. So it's 48 required from 19 deliveries. Last ball of the third over of Henry Brooks's spell coming. Been a great over so far. Let's hope he can finish it in style. Just going to be a single again. It was short. And it's cross-batted up to long on. And that's the end of the 17th over. 96 for 8. 47 required from the last 18 deliveries. And the pressure really mounting on these two Glamorgan batsmen.
Yeah, even more so now with Cheetan Patel coming back into the attack. Not an easy man to hit when you need as many runs and overs as they do.
I'd love to know what's being said between those two. They've both really got to swing the bat. It's not a scenario of probably just allowing one of them to 47 required in three overs. It's a real big ask. The Bears have done brilliantly to get to this point. Just tries to rock back and pull Jeeton away onto the leg side and nothing doing.
I've seen some optimistic appeals tonight. That might have been one of the more optimistic. The batsman's somewhere in the middle of the back, I think.
There have been a few optimistic ones tonight, to be fair. It's
still a big shout from Jeeton there.
Bit of pace on that one from Jeeton Patel. Off the pad, just be one as Burgess will scamper and collect. And this almost feels like, you know, it feels like one of those nights when the Bears used to go out, set a score, you know, so often around the 150, 160 mark, but they defended it for their lives, which is what they've done tonight.
Yeah, that was very much a trademark of certain T20 Birmingham sides. And this is very much a throwback to that kind of performance. It's not the kind of cricket that this team, I think, wants to play. I think they'd rather make big totals and go and defend those or chase them down. But they've responded. This is what's been required tonight, and the bowlers have really, really stepped up to the mark for them.
Of course, you were in those sides as well when very often you were performing in that manner.
Well, you said that. I think I was very often responsible for us having a lower than par score if I batted too long. we had a fantastic bowling unit that really knew their jobs and weren't afraid to try and win a game with a low total. And this side's looked very comfortable at it as well. They've looked confident. They've been very attacking, very positive with the ball in hand. And, you know, I think if they can finish this off, there'll be a lot of confidence to be gained.
Full toss from Jeeton Patel. Penultimate ball of the over. It's going to be a single. Brings the 100 up for Glamorgan. Just 13 deliveries remaining. 100 for 8. And that required run rate now, just touching 20 per over. Considering the start that Glamorgan had, 30 off the first, I think it was three overs. That's a big hit from Van der Gut, all the way for 6. Over the mid-wicket boundary. Well, maybe it's not over yet. 37 required off these final two overs. 106 for 8 is where we stand right now. A reminder, next up for Bears in the Vitality Blast will be that local derby versus the Worcestershire Rapids on Sunday. Here at Edgbaston is the return fixture against the Rapids next Friday, which we'll have live for you on Bears Den TV, as well as, of course, the final group game against the Northants Steelbacks. That's next Sunday afternoon, the 20th of September. Two overs to go then, 37 required, and Ollie Stone is picking up the next one from the Birmingham end. Bowling to Salter, who gets a thin edge on that, and that's through for 4. It's gone to the left of Burgess and to the right of Fine Leg. And all the way to the ropes for 4. 33 required off 11 deliveries. 2 wickets in hand. Still a job to be done here.
I think Ollie will be happy if that's the only place he can possibly get him away for a boundary. If he can keep the ball in and around there, he won't get away with that too often. So, you know, not a bad sign. Not a bad sign.
At this point, you really notice the lack of fans in a tight finish like this. How it is for the players trying to, when you are defending such a small title, you've needed that kind of energy and that intensity that would often be buoyed by the crowd. But they've done it themselves tonight, and they've done it brilliantly. Just going to be a single to Salter. And if they restricted them to another 10 of those, I think we'd all be quite happy. 1-1-1 for 8. Van der Gut on strike. Fine Leg has gone back to the ropes this time. That's Lintott. Just for those fuller deliveries. And that is a fuller one from Ollie Stone again. No contact from Van der Gut. Another dot ball ticks down. 9 to go. 32 required.
Really good this from Ollie Stone. He does love a contest. He loves these sorts of battles. He loves being involved in the crunch part of a game, and he looks really pumped up for this over.
When you consider the way he was carted when he opened up today by David Lloyd. That's straight down the ground, but he's not middled that. Now get back for a second. But two is fine. 30 required from eight. He's on to 20 now. Van der Gutten. Salter is on 10. Two balls left from Ollie Stone. Again, he's not middled it. This time it'll just be a single. Brings Salter on to strike. And clearly he's thinking that actually it's an opportunity for him maybe to unleash those arms and see what he can do. 29 required, last ball of the over. Eight off it so far. In the circumstances, that's more than good enough from Ollie Stone. Final ball of his spell. 2 for 30 so far for Stone. It's a full toss. And again, Salter's not anywhere near middled that. It's going to be a single. And we'll head into the final over then. With Glamorgan requiring 28 to win off the last over. Salter on 11. And Van der Gutten is on 21. It's a final chance for you to make your choice on tonight's 61 deep player of the match. Head to Twitter at Warwickshire County Cricket Club to cast your vote for us right now. Final over to go. Who's it going to be? Is Lintott, Rhodes, maybe Stone, Bresnan, any of those candidates? But your vote counts for the 61 deep player of the match. Just head to at Warwickshire County Cricket Club on Twitter to cast your vote. Henry Brooks to see us home, Tim.
Yeah, he's... He's bowled very well, I think, this game, Henry's. He's just aired on the short side a couple of times and paid for it, but it'll be quite a clear plan here. He'll be either quite full at the stumps or into the wicket with pace off with the field.
He bowls to Salter, who goes down the ground. Does he manage to find the gap? Or is that going to be cut off? It is cut off in the end and cut off well. Adam Ho's doing the fielding.
Yeah, another guy, Henry, who absolutely loves the contest, loves being involved in the crucial part of games. Him and Ollie Stone are two very good competitors to have bowl these two crucial overs for the Bears. But yeah, they'll be wanting to get this one right and cap it off to another bit of experience to go under their belt.
27 required off 5. Brooks is in, short. Sure. He's got all of that, and that's going all the way for 6. He's bowled it a little bit slower. The bouncer into the wicket. And it's hammered back down the ground by Van der Gutten. All the way for 6. And it's still alive for Glamorgan. 21 required off 4.
We saw a tense finish down at Taunton, didn't we? I think it was Lamanby. Nearly clubbed a few in the last over to get them back into it there. So they won't want it to get too tight here, that's for sure.
Another full toss from Brooks. It's down the ground. And this one's not going to be cut off, is it? It's going to go all the way for 4. No, he's done it again, Adam Hose. That's a terrific stop. Well, he saved a couple of runs there. That's for sure. Van der Gutten just gets 2. It looked like a sure boundary. And now, unless we're going to see wides or no balls, 19 required from 3 balls. It's an impossible task from Glamorgan. Turn that round the corner. That's going to be 4 more. Off the legs. It's a good knock this from Van der Gutten at the end. He's on to 33. 1-2-8 for 8 now for Glamorgan. 15 required then. Off 2 balls. Coming in at number 9. He's certainly had an impact.
Yeah, he's played very well. Quite a few of the lads down the order in this game have scored some handy runs. It does make you wonder if... The batsman up top, someone, just one of them, hung around for a little bit longer and create a bit more of a base for some of the hitting, but I'll have to recap all that at the end of the game between themselves, I think.
It's a full delivery again from Henry. Just going to be a single. So Glamorgan are going to fall short here. It's going to be a terrific, terrific win for the Birmingham Bears. Back-to-back victories that will lift them up onto 7 points in the table. Somerset are still in action, actually, in their game against the Worcester Rapids. They require 24 from two overs. And obviously Somerset on 5 points as well prior to tonight's fixtures getting underway. Last ball then from Henry Brooks. And it's back to him. There's no run. And it's a victory for the Birmingham Bears. And what a super win it is as well. They've managed to secure victory here as Glamorgan finish on 129 for 8, having set a target of 143, having finished on 142 for 9. It looked as though it wasn't going to be enough and maybe 20 runs shy, but a terrific effort in the field from the Birmingham Bears has managed to deliver. Tim Ambrose, what a performance.
What a fantastic effort, absolutely. That is a really great performance, and you could see at the end there that you could hear the roar from the Bears players and the bench. You know, it almost felt like we had a crowd for a moment. They were that excited with that, but they would have known that that would have required something special at the halfway mark to go out there and restrict them not only to a victory, but to win by 14 runs is a fantastic performance. And as you said, Glamorgan got off to a decent start as well, so they were up against it quite early, but never gave up, never took their foot off the gas, and they've really earned that. That victory. Will Rhodes still pumping his fist down there. He's really enjoyed that one. That was a really fine performance from the bowlers and the fielding unit. Missed a few opportunities, but they kept coming and they kept creating them. And as I say, that's a very, very impressive win from Birmingham. They'll gain a lot of confidence from that.
You've been in that dressing room in those kind of scenarios. And actually often, when the Bears have made it to finals day, it's been with a kind of mid-term like shift in momentum. Wins like tonight and that tight win down at Taunton really do provide something extra, don't they?
Yeah, I think we spoke before. It's we may haven't batted first and been able to defend totals like that for a little while. We haven't found that to be a real positive or a real strong factor for this team, this particular group. But they've certainly done it there, and that's just another way of winning that you get under your belt. And you know, you could come up against all sorts of scenarios come quarterfinals, finals day. And as I say, that's just another way of winning, and you gain a lot of confidence from that. And that's something that over the rest of this campaign and over the next few seasons, they will look back on that kind of victory and say, you know, remember when we did that, what we did, how we did it. We can go out and defend this total, and that will be something that they'll call back on in the future. That was a really, really fantastic team performance in the field and with the ball.
So many good performances tonight. Obviously, we were talking about the 61 deep player of the match vote that's going on Twitter. I mean, if you go back to the Bears batting, I mean, Rhodes' 46 was exceptional in the context of what everyone else has delivered. But you look at the contributions from people like Ollie Stone, you know, at the end there with those 22 runs, which actually proved really quite crucial in the end.
Yeah, it was. And I mean, the word we've been using all night's been momentum. And that was a really good example of it there. Ollie Stone sort of picking a few up at the end and getting a few over the ropes, giving the guys on the bench something to cheer about. And, you know, he sort of hit the last ball to the fence and then ran straight through into the change room. And I can assure you he was pretty pumped up at that point. He'd been geeing the guys up and making sure that we weren't going to just go out there and go through 20 overs. We were going out there to win that game. So, you know, that kind of energy that's created by those sorts of innings. But good point about Will Rhodes' innings as well. I thought it was very well measured. He was unlucky to be run out when he was, but he took great options when he needed to and measured it very, very well. So, you know, it does. If you're going to nitpick, that would be one thing to say is one of the batters really should have batted through probably 15 overs of that innings and maybe left too much work for the bowlers at the end. But they responded, and that's why you've got 11 batsmen in the team.
Just running through the bowling figures, actually, because they did bowl so well. Tim Bresnam is 4 overs up top from the beginning. So he bowled 3 of those in the power play. In a 4 overs, no maiden, 3 for 26. Ollie Stone, 4 overs, no maiden, 2 for 31. Which, when you put with his runs as well, it's a terrific all-round performance from him. Jeetan Patel, 4 overs, no maidens, none for 27. So wicketless tonight. But again, the pressure he applied mid-innings was terrific. Jake Lintott, I mean, we said it earlier that, you know, it's the fourth most economic full spell for the Bears, i.e. 4 overs in T20 cricket, behind Ricky Clark, who's done it twice, and Chris Wokes, who is ahead of him on that list. But 4 overs, no maiden, 3 for 11, included a drop catch, so he potentially could have had an extra wicket as well. And then Henry Brooks, four overs, no maidens, naught for 33. So it was, as an all-round bowling unit, that's quite impressive.
Yeah, it's much like chasing a large total, sort of having to go out and chase a 200, 210. You know that one guy's going to have to play an absolutely fantastic, probably a career best knock. And then three or four guys are going to have to chip in with really, really good cameos around it to sort of do that. And this was the bowling version of that, if you like. I think Jake Lintott was fantastic. Obviously, the standout performance, probably his best figures, I would imagine. And, you know, everyone else as well doing a really good job at crucial moments as well. Tim Bresnan up front and, you know, the comeback overs from Oliver Stone there when he didn't start too well with the ball, the way he came back with it was a really, really fine performance as well. But everybody chipped in, and as you say, it was a good all-round performance, and that's exactly what you need to defend that kind of total, and to defend it and win the game by 14 runs is also very impressive.
Next up, it's the old enemy. We'd always rather be a bear than a pair. Worcester on Sunday. And then obviously Worcester back here again. They've got Gloucester in midweek as well, who have kind of been setting the tone at the top of the table, them and Northants in this group. It's a difficult group to get out of because it looks like Somerset, who require six runs from three balls, are going to beat Worcester. So, I mean, that will put Worcester firmly rooted at the bottom of the table. But it's good that Worcester are getting beaten tonight with the Bears going there on Sunday.
Yeah, it's always, as a Bear, it's always good that Worcester are losing, I guess. But you're right about the group. It does look like we have three very strong teams and only two guaranteed to go through. So it might be difficult come the end. But as you say, two games against the old enemy to come. And, you know, they'll be difficult without the crowd. I mean, there's very, very special atmospheres for those particular derbies. So, you know, guys will have to have a different feel about that game. But there's still a lot to play for. And as I say, with only two spots guaranteed, and keep getting the W's.
Potentially getting a little tighter down at Taunton. Somerset need five from two balls to get the victory over Worcester. And, of course, that would keep them level on. And then the Bears will move up to third place this evening. Thanks, Tim, for your company tonight. A terrific performance from the Birmingham Bears here on the Bears Den TV. A super win in the end. It looked difficult at half time, but they pulled it out with some terrific, terrific bowling in the second part of the game. It's a 13-run victory over Glamorgan. Wonderful stuff from the Birmingham Bears tonight. And let's hand you back for the post-match analysis and to hear from the players.
Yes, we're going to be hearing from your 61 deep player off the match very, very shortly. We'll be catching up with the skipper as well, but first I'm back with Brian. Brian, be honest with me, because we're all friends here. When we were standing here at the start of the innings, did you think we were going to win?
Yes. No. The Birmingham Bears had to, they're probably 20, 30 runs short, I would imagine. They had to bowl very, very well, and they did, didn't they? It was a great collective bowling effort. Tim Bresnan taking three up front, big wickets those. Ollie Stone coming back from some early punishment to take a couple of big wickets. And what can we say about Jake Lintott? You know, hardly, most of the Bears fans have probably barely heard of him before T20 campaign began today. 3 for 11, the fourth most economical spell in T20 for the Bears, behind a couple from Ricky Clark and one from Chris Wokes. That's big company to be in, and he turned the match again today.
Who was your standout performance then?
I would say Lintott, but also you've got to look at Will Rhodes as well, haven't you? Without his 46, because the Bears did underperform with the bat again. Rhodes went in with his side in a bit of trouble, played very calmly, got himself a T20 career best, and was probably going to add quite a few more to it. Unfortunately, he was run out, which was something that the Bears will probably be talking about later on, because you can't really afford to take too many self-inflicted wounds in T20, but they did take that one and they bounced back from it. But Rhodes certainly, that was a match-turning 46.
For you, Brian, going into the next game, obviously it's Worcester, the old enemy. How important was that win?
Well, these two wins on this one and Somerset, it's just got a bit of momentum behind the Bears. We all know how disappointing the previous two games had been. Really, really, really bad defeats, which Jim Troughton and the players were first to hold their hands up and say the Northants and Gloucestershire defeats were bad ones. And they've shown a lot of character and a lot of resilience and a lot of skill to bounce back. Now they're on the front foot in the group. Four to play. Maybe two wins would do. They'll be looking for more than that, of course. And, of course, Worcester and the old enemy up next.
Facing Worcester, we've got them twice in a row.
Yeah.
It's not ideal.
Well, it's not ideal, but I suppose Moeen Ali, I don't think, will be available for them because he habitually hands out the Bears a bit of punishment in white ball cricket, doesn't he? So that's one good thing. But Worcestershire are always dangerous, of course. I mean, they're not having a great time in this year's tournament. It's very tight there. I don't know whether they've come out on top against Somerset this evening. They've beaten Somerset. Well, that'll give now that you see that makes it very interesting on Sunday because Worcestershire are now back in the mix. So that really does make it an interesting game at New Road on Sunday. But if the Bears can come out again on top there, that'll be three wins on the trot, and that's the sort of momentum that you want to build in the second half of the group.
We should just point out it's very technical in here. All the lights have gone off, and that was written on a piece of paper. We couldn't really see it, but yes, so Worcester have beaten Somerset. So. That's a bit of a game changer.
It is. So the Bears now go from here to New Road on Sunday, then Bristol on Tuesday, of course, and then it's potentially a really big doubleheader at home back in the Bears' Den, of course, next Friday and Sunday against Worcestershire and Northamptonshire. So it's very much game on. But I think the Bears have just shown a lot of resolve here. I mean, T20, there's a lot about big hitting and a bit of a glamour and... There's also a lot about cricket skill and mental strength, and the Bears they didn't make a great start tonight. They were 2 for 2 at Taunton last Friday. In both cases, they just stayed calm and they showed their strength and they won the games, and that's what you've got to do in T20.
I think it can be tough being a Bears fan, can't it? You get put the ringer sometimes, but when the outcome is like tonight, it is,
yeah. So it's such a shame, isn't it, that the fans, that the spectators can't be here. T20 is truly strange, isn't it, without the supporters in the ground. And hopefully they'll be back in full voice next year. But hopefully it was good watching for everybody watching on the live stream. And especially when Glamorgan went from 79 for 4 to 83 for 8. I mean, that's the sort of match-turning spell of a game that does make it worthwhile. Even some of the less great moments of being a Bears fan.
Hello and good evening, and I am joined by our 61 deep player of the match, Jake Lintott. Exceptional figures for you tonight. You are the fourth most economical spell for the Bears with your your averages tonight. Amazing. How does it feel? Because, you know, before this you were, you know, teaching, and now you've come out and you've got player of the match twice in a row.
Yeah, it's been a pretty surreal couple of weeks that I've just tried to enjoy as much as possible. The lads have been unbelievable in terms of welcoming me to the group, which I think is so important when you're coming from outside, and that's been a big thing for me. And I've been backed by all the coaching staff, and I'm just going out having fun and enjoying my cricket, which I think is so important. It's the most important thing, that you just got to enjoy it, and that's reflected in my performances, and I'm really happy.
Glamorgan, clearly the team for you.
Yeah, no, it's gone all right against them. yeah, just, you know, I've just tried to bowl, spin it both ways and try and make it difficult for them, and it's paid off. It's 2020 cricket, it's a bit funny, it can go both ways, and tonight, like, I bowled a few bad balls and got away with them, and it, you know, that's how it goes, but really happy with how it's gone, and yeah, happy with the figures.
There's a saying here, once a bear, always a bear. How does it feel to be a bear?
Yeah, that's something that I've noticed straight away, is everyone is so behind the club and desperate to do well for the club, and it's a real tight-knit group. Like I said, they've welcomed me incredibly well, and yeah, feel a real part of it, which is awesome.
Next up, it's Worcester, which is, of course, a huge clash. It's the local derby.
Yeah.
How are you feeling about going into that for the first time, but also, you know, knowing that you're coming off the back of this win, which was so crucial?
Yeah, I think we're really looking forward to obviously playing a rival. It's a big game, and we go with that with a lot of confidence, but we still know we can be better as well. There's areas that we can improve tonight. I mean, you know, there's little things that we know we've got to work on and keep moving forward, but each game at a time. And yeah, I feel like the change room's buzzing, and the lads just want to get out there on Sunday and put on another good show and hopefully get another 2 points.
It's often the way that player of the match tends to go to the batsman. For the last two, it's been you as a bowler. How do you feel about that?
Yeah, no, again, though, it's just, we're all, I think all the bowlers are mucking in and doing their jobs. And, you know, even bowling a lot of bowlers in the power play tonight, took wickets, put pressure on, and then we took that into the middle overs, and Jeets has squeezed, I've squeezed. And, you know, we're all working together. And then the seamers at the end, Stoney's bowled really well, pulled it back nicely. And yeah, I mean, everyone's mucking in, so it's not just me. I mean, they're making my job a bit easier by bowling so well as well.
Well, if you could take that form to Worcester, we'd be very happy. Thank you very Hopefully. Much. Congratulations.
Cheers.
Player of the match, Jake Lintott. We're going to be catching up with the skipper very shortly. A win, Will. How are you feeling?
Yeah, ecstatic. You know, the boys were excellent, weren't they? That fielding performance is the sort of thing that gives you a lot of confidence going through to the last stage of the groups. So, yeah, very pleased with how it went, and hopefully we can replicate that on Sunday.
Well, we need to talk about your knock, because it is your best T20 knock, 46, just shy of your half century. How are you feeling about that?
Yeah, it's nice to contribute on a personal note. I think, you know, I've probably been a bit short of runs in this comp so far, so to get that is very pleasing, and to get us up to some sort of total was nice. Obviously, probably a little bit short of where we wanted to be at half time, you know, 142 I think we got, so we're probably 15 short of where we wanted to be on that wicket. So a bit disappointed to get on the end, but obviously now it's you know, that's forgiven.
I don't really like to sort of talk about it, because I know it's probably not what you want to talk about, but that run out, it's what everyone was talking about. How are you sort of feeling about that at the moment?
It was probably my fault. It's actually the third time I've been run out this year, which I make a bit of a habit, really. So the other two probably weren't my fault, but that one was probably my fault. I should have got out of the blocks a little bit quicker. Henry was doing the right thing, getting me back on strike. So We'll probably have a beer and a chat about it tonight, but it's probably my fault.
You're heading down the road to Worcester. Obviously, we'd all rather be Bears than Pears. They have won tonight. You've won tonight. Does that give us more of a clash, do you think?
A little bit. It probably keeps them just about in the competition. And I think, you know, obviously we're going nicely as well with two wins from two. So you should never have to go for a Bears v Pears game. And I think there's just going to be that added incentive to win. It's probably an all or nothing for both teams. So, it makes it for an extra, tasty affair.
Well, we will look forward to that. Thank you, Will. I'll let you go and have your beer. Cheers. And your chat with Henry Brooks. Of course, the Bears are off down the road to Worcester. Who is going to come out on top in the Norman Gifford Trophy this year? You'll have to stick around. We'll be back in the Bears Den next Friday night. Don't miss it. See ya.